It's 6-0.
I mean, it may be New Mexico or Arizona. It's one of those Southwest states. Stratomanus will be here.
Melody, yeah, I saw that. Here today. Wait, yeah. Stratomanus is... Oh, that's some bull.
Well, Melody's going to be on the phone?
Yeah.
So what's going on here, man? Is this... What, give me the ground rules.
I don't know what the ground rules means. You set it up.
I don't have ground... Man, basically, we had this conversation about the... And our discussion of it, and she was like, we are 100% in support of the library. I was like, well, you're going to have to explain that. I was like, because I can't just...
What's the deal, man? I mean, is this, I mean, shit's going on here, and I don't know. I don't know what's going on.
I mean, I don't... There is nothing going on. No, she's...
I have a reputation and a brand to protect. I'm just hearing now that there's going to be a staged interview with MTV. Now I'm hearing that there's Melody and Stratomanus are going to come on to promote, and I am not to ask any...
Well,
nobody said that.
Nobody
said that at all.
That Melody's...
Well, I don't know nothing about it.
No, but okay,
nobody's...
So she's...
Me shit. I live here. I work here. Okay, I gotta know. Really?
Melody is coming on the air to do an interview about the Obama Library. There are no ground rules. She is coming on as a guest the same way anyone else would come on a guest, okay. As a guest. As it relates to MTV, we can record it at 4:00 in the morning if we need to.
Yeah,
we can record when there's nobody here. We don't want
to
compromise anyone's brand.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, I heard on the air. That's what I heard.
We can record on the air.
I mean,
at 5:00, at 4:00, yeah. At whatever time we need to do it. Let's talk about it.
Yeah, we can do it at noon.
Yes.
Yeah. But not on the air.
We can. Yeah. No, we can still do it on the air.
It may be airworthy.
It is airworthy. I mean, you don't have to be in it. Yeah, we can shoot this way. We can just do
Doma T. The topic is a genuine topic that's
right.
That we can touch on, and Doma T would be a good person to talk to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Doma T is narrating the whole special.
Yeah.
And so at the culmination of the special is the buzz locally started here.
Yeah.
Right? Doma T is now, helped Doma T become the narrator of the joint. They want to wrap it with, man, we did all of this stuff. We talked about all these conspiracies, but we never said who is this girl.
Right.
And that's it. So we could do that whenever. We're here. Whew. We do it.
And Otis will be here too. Otis is coming too.
Yeah, Otis will be here.
Yeah.
Good morning, Chicago. Good morning, world. This is the WVON Morning Show. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. You know what, man? It is Friday morning. Yesterday I woke up, it was 60 degrees. I came out the door today, and it was 30. Charles, how you doing this morning, man?
Hey, I'm doing all right, man. It's better than 2, 3, 5 degrees or below zero, man. I'm cool.
Man, you know what? This weather is something else. This is like I don't want to call it the flu weather. It's already the flu season. But it seems like this is like that catch a cold weather where you might catch pneumonia or something because you keep going up and down. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the WVON Morning Show. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Now, Annette, I thought we had a chance to put Das Vidanya away, but apparently we got snow showers coming. And apparently you don't have a microphone, so
you're right.
Okay, there you go. Okay.
Charles is gonna get those 2 degrees again.
Oh, good, but I won't be up at 4:00 in the morning.
Right, you can enjoy that. It's great to enjoy one of the best feelings in the world is to when it's 2, 3 below zero, you hear the wind howling, and then guess what? Exactly. You can put the covers right back over your head and not have to feel any of it. Now, you know we cannot fly the soul plane without the music conductor, Miss Sonia Escobar. Sonia, how you feeling this morning? You know, that is because they are building our DJ booth. They are in the process of building our DJ booth, and we must stop traffic and let 87th Street, boy, you can see it coming. You start coming around the curve, boy, used to be, you know, I hit 87th and be like, shh, I'll be coming. Well, I ain't going to say how I'll be coming off of it. But now when our DJ booth is almost ready, though. Okay. Speaking of stopping traffic, you got something you want to say?
I do. I think you're getting ready to go there, and then I'm going to say something.
Speaking of stopping traffic, I said last week, that's it. Donald Trump, you can't top it. You cannot top it. And then, Charles?
But let me say something first, always. We ahead. Just had the man in here, you know, who is the program director at right. WVON. And we talked about the show, but we didn't decide, and the man, I want you to get involved here, whether or not we're going to say what the president said.
Ooh!
We haven't discussed that.
Well, they are, turn around. Look right there. They're printing it on the news right now. Yeah. CNN. So, can we decide? Okay, look.
Have you been told?
So the rule has always been there's certain words that you can't say, but when it is newsworthy and a president or a national, international leader says something that's inappropriate and it is actually newsworthy, you can go ahead and say it. But
shit!
Whoa!
I don't see the point. I don't see the point in saying that. You know, there's no point because we all know what...
So we're not going to say it?
So we all know. So we all know what the word is. So what's the point? Why do you have to use the word what the word is? Why do you just say the N-word and not use the other word all the time?
Did you really have to go?
I'm just
get
saying.
Out! You got to go. You got to go.
So the word is banned?
No, it's not. But we use it on the show.
Are we going to use it today?
I can't. You know, it's been used before. Callers have said it. Caller said it yesterday.
So we can use it.
If it's appropriate, you don't have to go out of your way to be offensive.
Okay, I've never said that. I mean, I've been broadcasting 45 years, and I've never used...
Shithole?
I've never said shithole on the radio.
Shithole.
I never have.
Well, when it's used in proper context, you know, it's...
Are you going to use it today?
It can technically, legally be used, but I do not see a point in using it.
Mm-hmm. So you're the boss, make a call.
There's no point in using it. There's no point.
So don't use it?
I don't say
there's... Don't use it. Don't use it, or
you can say asshole, and it's more fun to say asshole.
Asshole.
Or shhole. Or
asshole.
You know, I can't call it shitole. Shitole?
Yes.
Can I use shitole?
That sounds like a...
But I tell you, man, CNN, man, they were like...
It's on CNN right now.
But CNN is not free airwaves.
It's what?
Look, the man. Look, hey, look, you the man. We ain't trying to trick, man. We're not trying to compromise your authority, man.
I already dropped a couple of S1s.
We just wanted to know what it was. We just wanted you to make the cut. Look, y'all done started already. You know what?
I don't know.
Y'all done started up on Friday already. The man done stormed out the studio, and Donald Trump done changed the game again.
Again, and we talked last week. Didn't you say last week that, hey, he's gone off the list.
What did he do last week? I forgot.
I forgot too.
What did he do last week that I forgot? I mean, Donald Trump can make you forget. Did he shoot somebody? I can't remember
I can't
what,
even
he
what he did. I was trying to remember.
I mean, and
was
this
thing with
nothing.
Bannon? Was it the Bannon thing?
No, something else. He said, you know what? I can't remember I still get stuck on Grab Him in the Biscuit. Right, I'm still back at the biscuits. And I am now officially starting to believe that Donald Trump can literally do what he said, which is walk into the middle of Times Square, pull it, and his people would still support him. But can I tell you something about this whole comment yesterday? I was a lot, this isn't as bad as I thought it was gonna be. Cause Charles, yesterday when I saw them reporting on the story, they said, Donald Trump refers to African nations and Haiti as an expletive. We can't even, and then all the black talking heads came up. It was Senator Booker. It was all just black people. I was like, did he call them countries? I was like, he couldn't possibly have said countries. So I went straight to the internet, right? I held my breath because I was like, did he? And then when I saw it was Sitoli's,
yeah.
I said Sito. I took the H out. I took a deep breath. Sitoli's. I took a breath. Because it was on. He only said Sitoli's. He didn't say. I thought he was calling us. I thought they was.
Him a pass?
I'm not giving him a pass. I'm just saying. He said, see, if he was only talking about black countries, I would be extra mad. But because he said, like, El Salvador and some other people, he kind of lumped everybody together. But they tried to make it a black thing. So, well, no, I'm not giving him a pass.
He's made it a black thing. I think Donald Trump, during his first 11 months of his presidency, kind of, like, he didn't really come at black people. He didn't really come at black people. But now he has. I think he has crossed the racism Rubicon. You know what I'm saying? He's over there now. And he's, even his people.
Look, they're asking, is Trump racist?
Really?
Is that really a question? Like, I'm saying like this, though. He is who we thought he is. It's like, man, the man said Obama, he said he asked for Obama's birth certificate. And y'all trying to act like y'all didn't think he, you know what? See, y'all be acting brand new. I keep telling you, Donald Trump is who we thought he is. Well, he showed you.
And he showed.
He is showing you. But I'm just going to ask Charles, the fact that he said El Salvador too lightened it up just a little for me. Because I was just like, well, at least he didn't just say only the black countries. Because you know what? I know a lot of black people that don't want to go to Africa while you tripping. It's the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. You know what else, man? Donald Trump called ICE. On 7-Eleven, Charles. The dude is off the chain. We'll be back after traffic and the weather. Okay, what are we saying? So, what are we going to call it? Yeah. Charles made Todd mad. Todd is mad.
What?
Woo!
Todd is mad
because
I said,
no, I don't know. But he stormed up out this mug. That was funny because I don't never really see Todd get mad.
Well, Todd, was he mad?
I think he was.
Why? Todd, you mad? Come on, man. Everybody's on the escort now, man. Everybody's on the escort.
I mean, I'm just saying all our kids wake up on the news to hearing Sitoli now. What's up with that? Oh, y'all, look at y'all. Y'all rocking and rolling. 70 before 7? 70 before 6:15. Okay, let's say what's up. All right, what up, Felicia Simmons-Stovall, Denise Sims, Kang Mufasa Red, Rick Good, Elena Moore. Hey, y'all, can y'all do me a favor? Can y'all share the broadcast early and often today? Share it early and often today. We are trying to get those numbers up. Right, Dennis, I'm saying I'm not surprised by anything Donald Trump says. Regina Alexander, and I am telling y'all, I know y'all know it sounds crazy, but I did, I swear to God, I was like, did he just say nigga countries? I really did. I was like, oh, and then the way they did it, like all the black people were like, I'm outraged. And the white guys was like, right? They didn't really say too much about it. Man, I went straight to the internet to see, what did he say? And I am going to be honest with you. I mean, you know, I'm trying to be honest with y'all. When I realized that he didn't say nigger countries and that he said shithole countries, I really did take a deep breath. Now, I'm not giving him a pass. And then when I read out the whole quote and I realized it wasn't just black countries, right? Because I'm just saying, okay, this is not to be offensive. Anybody signing up to go on vacation to Haiti? Anybody? No disrespect. Shout out to my main man, Patrick Brutus, and the people from Haiti. Shout out to Senator Raul and the Haitian community. I want to show you much love and respect, but I'm just telling you, Donald Trump ain't loving nobody. Nobody. What up, Alvin? What up, Amina? What up, Dennis? What up, Raymond Hubbard? What up, Felicia Muhammad? What up, Regina Alexander? K.M. Milton? What up, Erica Swain? What up, Kang? What up, Sheila Muldrow Kellogg? Sonia Escobese? I said Dennis Evan. What up, Belinda Connor York? You have a wonderful day, too. What up, Ship, Rob, Payback, Ellis, Hotep, Henry Hartsfeld, Melvin Griffin, what up, my brother, Ron Lewis, Sharon Lyles, you hear me do it like they do it in the prayers, Regina Alexander, Michelle Flay, good morning, Elena Moore, good morning, Dennis Evans, what up, Michelle Flagg, Nanette Jones? What up, Percy Jackson? What up, Marvin Edwards? What up, Kang? All right, y'all. Let's get it cracking. So I am trying. What's up, YouTube? So I can't see any comments on YouTube today.
Fire and Fury gone, man. Anybody talk about Fire and Fury no more?
There it is. That's what it was. Fire and Fury.
Anybody talk about that, man? That's over, boy.
So just want to let you know, you got to say my. It's in the mood to make it right. It's a beautiful thing. Over town. Take a moment, share the broadcast. Doing what we do. Chilling on the aisle. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Charles, I got more Donald Trump. But before I go to Donald Trump, before we go back to Donald Trump, have you seen these political ads that are starting to fly on air right now, Charles? Did you hear the story about the governor? Have you seen that? Did you see the Mike Madigan ad? Thanks, Mike Madigan ad.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure everybody saw that.
That was kind of funny, man. I thought that was kind of a funny ad.
Dudes on the ad, man, has got some issues.
Man, what that story is kind of crazy. He tied a woman up. The governor of, was it the governor from your state?
Missouri, right? My home state.
My fault.
I got to live through this, but
so Charles, what was his name? Eric
Greitens.
That's it, yeah. Greitens.
He apparently had an affair with some woman, and the woman's. And which he apologizes for, he says, but the woman's husband says that at one point he had pictures. He tied up his girlfriend, the woman he was having an affair with.
With her, against her will, or?
I guess she agreed, but there was allegedly a photograph of her tied up, and Eric Greitens, the governor of Missouri, says, hey, look, if you say anything about this, I'm going to put this picture out there in the social media world or whatever. So better keep your mouth shut. So he denies that part of it, although he admits to the affair and that he and his wife are making up. And apparently the affair happened before he was governor.
Oh, okay. And he's a former Navy SEAL. If I was dude, I'd be cool. Messing with them former Navy SEALs. But it apparently has forced Governor Rauner to pull that commercial. And then instead, Charles, we talked about this yesterday. He has put up this scathing ad against with J.B. Pritzker and Rob Blagojevich on tape.
Right.
Well, Charles.
We have that ad.
Do we have it? Sonya, play the ad.
Okay, so, but what if? And I'm telling you, this could happen. Because I know how Madigan is. He says, I'll give you health care, I'll give you a capital bill. Okay? I'll balance the what works with you to balance the budget the way you want to do it. I'll raise taxes on people. And I can make Lisa the senator. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
That puts me in a moral dilemma. Because of all of the prospective candidates, what dealing with her, suing us to support Bush kicking 35,000 poor people off of health care.
Yeah, I know.
Y'all that
do it. You should do it. I take that
morally wrong. I probably have to do it.
I do it.
Okay, and then there's an AG I can appoint, JB.
Doing the right thing for the people.
Are you a lawyer?
Yeah.
There's an AG that I appoint.
Oh, that's it.
You see what I'm saying?
Oh, there you go.
I mean, don't rule that one out.
Okay.
I mean, I'm not promising. I'm just saying these are all scenarios.
You see how those guys be plotting. See, we sit here talk about them plotting all the time.
It's not a conspiracy.
Not a conspiracy, not strategic, whatever. It's, you know, they always tell us that they're not. Oh man, they tell you.
No, I'm still Charles.
Wake up, Charles.
I'm still, you know me though. I'm still betting on JB, but boy, what in the heck is Bruce Rauner thinking?
You know, the thing is that who is this going to help? Who's this ad going to help right now?
I bet you who it's going to help. It's going to help the green team, which is on the move.
It's going to help Chris Kennedy,
man.
Right.
I don't know why the governor would be attacking J.B. Pritzker.
Now.
That's crazy to me. Because all it seems to do is give him a tougher opponent, right? I think, let me just say that. I think that there's going to be, and we've talked about this, JB's got some work to do once he gets out of the primary, if he makes it out of the primary, the way these things are adding up. But I think that there's going to be a lot of dog whistling downstate. I think that there's going to be a lot of challenges. But I think Kennedy doesn't face those same challenges because of that hope and change.
And they say Kennedy's not spending any money for advertising.
Why do you need to?
Why do you need to when Bruce Rauner is going to use part of his $75 million to run negative ads for in the Democratic primary? Usually, you really have to go some in a primary to run a negative ad against an opponent. Now, Rauner's running the negative ad that Kennedy probably wouldn't run on his own.
And couldn't probably afford to run
right.
That he's doing, only increasing Rauner's only doing the dirty work for Chris Kennedy, allowing Chris Kennedy to remain above the fray and manage that Kennedy mystique. Charles, I think they need some political consultant over there, man.
They sure do.
They. Somebody ain't thinking. But speaking of that, Green Team is on the move, brother. Green Team is on the move. Did you hear that the Kennedy clan? Did I call it the clan? Kennedy. So that's Kennedy. Is that clan with a K or a C?
I think it's a C.
Okay. The Kennedy clan, K or C, still up to be debated, is coming to town. They are coming to town, Charles, because they want to celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday. They coming for the White Women's March. And then they are coming for Reverend Jesse Jackson's King Day breakfast, which I'm hearing we may be broadcasting live.
Hey, and is Jesse Jackson Sr., is he endorsing yet in the Democratic primary?
No, but I know Jonathan is can you say balls to the wall? Jonathan is balls to the wall for J.B. Pritzker. And he is, I'm telling you. See, man, this is getting ready to turn to a battle of the Titans.
So Jonathan is in support of J.B. Pritzker.
Yes.
But Senior has not announced his support for anybody yet.
Yeah.
That could be interesting. That way the Jacksons could cover two bases within the party.
That used to be Jesse Jr.'s job. They used to split all the time, and you know, but they learned that trick from the Green Team, right? Because you know the Green Team. You know, they used to have, when it was the Dailies, boy, they'd have somebody on everybody's team. And then everybody come to family dinner and share your notes. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. When we come back, child, social media question of the day. You heard your boy Donald Trump sent ice to the 7-Eleven stores around the country. Well, I got a question. Would you support Donald Trump sending ice to raid hood corner stores? Let's talk about it when we come back. Give us a call, 773-591-1690.
Live from the WVON Newsroom, well, here's our news now.
Just a few
flurries,
more like a dozen.
And Melody's going to be on the phone.
Right. So, a little background on today's call. For those of you who saw or did not see the interview on this week where we talked to Ernest Brown and the other guy from John Bynes from the construction companies, we asked quite a few questions. We asked quite a few questions that apparently they were not prepared to answer and were not, and the interview was not necessarily received well. Additionally, we've been very critical of the lack of a community benefits agreement, and been pretty vociferous about that. So after the show on whatever day that was with the show, I got a call from upstairs suggesting that that WVON is in 100% support of the Obama Library. I personally have questions, but I don't own the radio station. and as I've always said, I'm going to continue to vociferously advocate for black people. At which point, the owner of the radio station said that WVON would not be an obstruction to the Obama Library. At that point, I suggested that the Obama Library had to be genuine in its efforts and don't come and sell us a dog and pony show regarding this project, knowing what was going to happen. Again, I don't own the radio station, but I said that I have, as my brother suggested, I have my own brand and my own credibility that I want to manage and maintain, but also want to maintain a radio show. So what I asked Melody to do was to come on and communicate to the WVON listening audience directly her position and explain it from the perspective of the radio station. From my perspective, I don't want to do anything that is disingenuous or that would compromise me, but I don't own the radio station. And so what I suggested was that she come on and explain her position, her understanding. She is a member of the board, and so I'm sure that it makes sense for her to be in support of the project. But I asked her to come on and explain and communicate what... I asked her to come on and explain and communicate the same thing she was saying to me, because it didn't make sense all to me, so I thought that it would be important for her to say it directly to the audience. I also suggested that if the goal is just to come on to our show and not answer the questions, that it would be much better if those things that are not right be directed to other shows or to other places, because we didn't want to compromise our integrity. I'm going to continue to ask what's in it for the black people. So, with that in mind, so we're all clear, there's no... So, radio station, I said, come on, the radio station, and let's talk about the situation. There are no guidelines to the conversation. There never were. But I, for me, with this whole thing, right? I'm trying to manage it. I'm trying to learn how to balance being an employee of someone, right? Compared to the ownership of, I don't own the station. And so this is one of those times where I suggested that you come on and explain it. And I just, for me, I could just sit it out, right? I don't have to talk about that situation there. I will use the other platforms. This isn't the only platform that I have to communicate, but I also don't own the radio station. So that was the genesis, the gist of. I will tell you up front, I'm a friend with Mike Stratmanis. We went to college together. Mike looked out for me years before any of this Obama stuff and was always straight up and genuine, which is why I was trying to give him a fair shot, but always ask the tough questions. And there's what we should expect at 7 o'clock, but I don't think that there's any holding back. I think WVON listeners, the Den, all y'all, but I think y'all should call as compared to just typing your comments on air. I think you, if you have questions, I think you really should call and we should just go directly there. That would be me. All right? This is, however, I will tell you, this is funny because this is the part of the reason I've always owned my own stuff. I ain't really never worked for nobody, so I can say what I want to say, do what I want to do. But I think they got a tremendous vested interest, just like the sponsors, just like, I don't know, man. So, got to pay your bills. Who am I to tell somebody what they could do on their own joint? So, we'll go from there. All right? Let's talk Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Take a moment, share the broadcast, please. My internet is not working very well within the studio. What's up, Ron Lewis? What up? What up, Kenya Love and Harmony? What up? What up, Randy Daniels? I agree, Randy. What up, Carol Muhammad? What up, Sheila Aiken? What up, Amina Hanan Muhammad? What up, Bob Israel? What up, Rod Crowder? What up, Reese Moe? What up, Sheila Muldrow Kellogg? What up, Kenya? What up, Dennis? Denise, what up, Double J? Double J, what's going on out in, what is going on out in the South Suburbs? Apparently, Al Riley did not make the ballot. What's going on? He was running.
But he said he wasn't.
He was running for committeeman.
Right.
And he didn't make the ballot.
For committeeman?
He didn't get the signatures. Really? He got bumped.
Dang, did not know that.
Gangsta out here right now. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Now, I want y'all to stay tuned because 7 o'clock, boy, 7 o'clock is going to be a big hour. We are going to be talking to, at 7 o'clock, we're going to be talking to Casey Toner of the BGA in his story, Taking Cover, How Suburban Cops Escape Discipline for Shooting in the Suburban Chicago. And then, y'all, at 7:30 a.m., Melody Spann-Cooper, along with Mike Stratmanis, coming on, the boss lady. You know, I heard, she heard, we've been popping, popping our chops. And so the boss lady said she's going to come in and tell the WVON listeners direct why WVON is in full support of the Obama Library. So we're going to have that conversation. Make sure you tune in because it ought to be a good one. But right now, Charles, social media question of the day. Charles, did you see that your boy Donald Trump was at it again with the 7-Elevens? He sent ICE to the 7-Eleven stores.
Well, yeah, I guess that the immigration people are cracking down on the 7-Eleven stores around the country.
Huh?
So I mean, that's part and parcel of what they've been doing everywhere, really. I mean, and 7-Eleven was a very easy target.
You didn't buy Simpsons. And they got all the people.
Right. We got a lot of people at
7-Eleven. Was it discriminant? Was he stereotyping when he went to the 7-Elevens? I mean, when I read that, I was like, 7-Elevens for real, I could think of was The Simpsons.
Yeah, you could probably do that. I mean, there are certain
companies, chains, that I think have more immigrant ownership. I mean, I'm looking at your iced coffee there.
That's one. Woo! Yeah. Subway.
Yeah, I mean, these are smaller franchise businesses that are that immigrants can get involved with, and I think 7-Eleven is one.
But I think your social media question goes to a more local concern, because we have a large immigrant population that is involved in neighborhood, what we call corner stores, and perhaps they could be a target.
So it got me to thinking, you know, because I know we don't like Donald Trump. I mean, he called everybody Satoli. He called the country Satolis. And I don't even know what's going on. But then I said, you know, in politics, use every crisis for an opportunity. Well, something like that.
Don't never let a good crisis go to waste. I think that might be a quote attributed to our mayor.
The Rhyme Father.
When he worked at the White House.
So I was thinking, Charles, for the social media question of the day, would black people support ICE raiding hood corner stores? Like, so all of those stores on the corners that are owned by people that may be of Arab descent do you think black people, I actually polled it yesterday on my Facebook page. And I could not believe the responses.
Well, yeah, but you know, the thing is, I think people have to be careful, because there's no suggestion that there's a lot of, number one, a lot of people working in those stores, because they don't have a lot of employees. It's usually the owner who's running the store.
And
they don't hire a lot of people from the community anyway. And then what's to say they are not legal residents of the United States? I mean, they could be. They could have green cards. They could have, you know, other statuses that would allow them to operate the stores. And they could be full-fledged citizens of the United States.
They could be.
Yeah.
But I wonder, would WVON listening audience support checking that out? Because, you know, it seems like we don't want to do the work ourselves. And it seems like ICE might be able to come in, kind of pick out the bad ones, sweep them up, and we can retake the stores.
I think it'd be a waste of time,
because I don't think there's enough people that you'd really catch. I think you'd be much better off going to a lot of the construction sites in the city, particularly those people who do a lot of the curb and street work.
You mm-hmm. see the crews out in the neighborhoods all the time, and they're mostly Latino, even though they're working in black neighborhoods. I bet you if you went to those subcontractors, city subcontractors, and started really asking who those people are who are working on those sites, you might come up with more violators that way. Because I was told by an alderman, a Latino alderman one time, he shall remain unnamed right now, that the city, that you cannot work for the city unless you have a green card. But when it comes to one of these subcontractors, the policy is don't ask, don't tell. That came from a long time Latino alderman in the city. In other words, if the company's based out in Summit or in the suburbs, and they're hiring laborers to go out and work on the streets in the city, that they don't have to be U.S. citizens necessarily.
Right. I 100% agree with that. So I guess my question is, I think we can expand it. Would you support ICE coming and checking out people's credentials in the city? Like, black folks, would you support ICE coming and checking out the corner stores? Would you support ICE? You know, I framed it with the 7-Elevens because they're already on it, right? And we know that 7-Elevens are kind of like the upgrade version that's in the white neighborhoods. But then, like, they get the franchise for the white neighborhoods. When they come to the black neighborhood, they open up that store. But, again, there are so many people in our communities taking advantage. Would you support ICE coming into the black neighborhood and or coming into the city of Chicago and removing immigrants that may have disenfranchised our community? Give us a call, 773-591-1690. I think yesterday when I was looking at this, one of the things that I heard was that somebody suggested that maybe we could identify stores, recommend ICE to them, and then have a plan to buy that store and take it over. That could be real interesting. We'll talk about it when we come back. It's the Talk Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson, Charles Thomas. We'll be back.
More of the Morning Show with Maze Jackson coming up on the Talk of Chicago.
So, how many of you all would support ICE coming into the stores? Felicia says yes. Kahinde, the only thing is they go hard on in the community, would rather suffer in the short term due to the lack of business available. What's up, man?
This, the story that you guys are talking about, he's got another story that he, yesterday or the day before that came out, that parallels with this about suburban cops being transient, going from force to force to force.
Yeah, well, that's how they do it to, right.
I'm printing that one up for you, too, right now. It's just taking a minute.
I'm mad that it sucks kind of that Melody's coming at 7 because yeah, it's
smack. It was originally at 8.
I thought it was at 8.
Yeah, she moved it. She moved it because she's got to go to some breakfast.
She got to go to the mayor's breakfast.
Jackson today. There's a breakfast at honoring Reverend Jackson today, this morning.
What? Where?
I'm not sure where.
It's not the, ain't today the mayor's breakfast for King?
Is it?
I think that's it.
I know she's going to speak to that.
Okay. All right. So again, you know, I think that you look at, I was yesterday when we were talking about, remember when the Latino girl jumped in and she said she couldn't believe the responses of all the black people saying yes, they would support. And I want to say there were only, out of the 60 something responses, there were only like 3 black people who said no. I think that there's a different perspective if you live, if you have to shop at those stores or if you frequent those stores compared to the work site. So I think the reason that I was speaking on the corner store is not necessarily because of the quantity of people, but really based on the respect or lack of respect of the community, right? Like, so to me, the Mexican guy who comes in and puts the curb and gutter in, he comes from 9 to 5, he pours it, he gets up and he leaves. That's a whole, that, not to negate that situation. That's one situation. But I think when I was talking about the corner stores, the reason I really focused on the corner stores is because of their lack of respect for the constituents in the community, right? We've talked about the gas station babies. We've talked about the under the low grade meat. We've talked about the extreme ridiculous markups. So the reason I asked was not so much about numbers, but really to gauge the sentiment, right? Because there is a universal, I'm not gonna say universal, but close to universal agreement that the corner store in the neighborhood is not necessarily beneficial. Now, it's a necessity, And because it's a necessity, we are forced to take the treatment that we get from those stores. But we also know that those stores tend to be dens of crime, right? You know that if you got the corner store, most of the guys are standing outside of it, right? You got the Lucy's coming out of there. You got the dope being sold out of there. You got the illegal alcohol being sold to minors out of there. I'm not talking about it from them stealing jobs from us. I'm talking about it from the perspective of them not being hospitable in our communities. And I think it's different. It comes off differently to someone who is Latino who goes into every store that in their neighborhood, and those stores in their neighborhoods are populated with Latinos who see them as their comrades or equals. I often feel like when you go into a corner store, they look down, they talk down, they speak down. Everything is, we're here to be here with you Negroes. And then they go. Same thing, right?
This is the story that...
Okay. We're probably going to have to need him to come back. Yeah. So, I want you to understand my perspective when I was talking about the conversation. I think... you look at where the hub of crime is. You look at where the cell... Remember how we talked about the cell phone stores and who finances the theft of the cell phone stores, etc.? Right? That's what I'm talking about. How many of the ills of our community are birthed from the corner store or fostered? Baby, baby, making love between the sheets. With style and grace, allow me to lace these lyrical dishes in your bushes. Hoorah cruise and make moves with all the mommies. The back of the club, sipping Moet is where you find me. The back of the club, making holes, my crew's behind me. Mad question asking, blunt passing, music blasting. Cause I just can't quit because one of these honeys, Biggie, got to creep with, sleep with, peep the epic secret. Why not? Why blow up my spot? Cause we both got pop. Now check it. More Mac than Craig and in the bed. Believe me, sweetie, I got enough to feed the needy. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. And we are asking the social media question of the day. It seems like Donald Trump released ICE on 7-Eleven stores across the country. But I was wondering, what would happen if he released ICE on the hood corner stores? Now, you know, I asked about the hood corner stores, just not because of the quantity. Charles, you had, and I agree with you on the on if ICE was launched in our community and they went to work sites, they catch a lot of people. But the reason I asked about the corner stores is because they seem to be not a den of iniquity, but they seem to be like the hubs of social ills in our community for some reason.
The thing is, ICE is looking for people who have problems with their immigration status. And I just wonder how many of these business people actually have that problem. Now, they're doing a lot of stuff, as you mentioned, that's wrong, but ICE doesn't have any jurisdiction to arrest them, for instance, for selling loose cigarettes. ICE's jurisdiction is their citizenship status.
But if ICE knew that they were selling loose cigarettes or selling those products and then using that money and sending it back to the other country where it could fund, which we've also heard, mm-hmm. which oftentimes has been the case, even with the food stamp fraud, right, when they talked about how it financed some of our terrorism, would it be worthwhile to take a look? Let's go to the phone lines. James, you're on the Talk of Chicago. Would you support ICE going after hood corner stores?
Absolutely. I take it even one further. I think we should start deputizing ourselves as ICE agents and go into their community and start identifying them and turn them into ICE. Get them out of the community, period, out off of the corner stores, off of the streets and on construction projects and out of the community, period. They're using those people to replace us.
Dang, James, you kind of harsh there, brother. I don't know if you remember Donald Trump's first State of the Union speech. And he talked about, remember when he had that black man who was sitting up there who got his son died because of some illegal immigrant, and then he talked about having this giant ice core of people. It made me think of like Hitler Youth, but I could also see people, would black people be turning people in? Do you think? I don't know. Curtis, what do you say? You on the talk of Chicago?
Good morning, Mays and Charles, man. I think you got a super team, man. I mean, I'm expecting big things out of you guys, man, in the future. You guys need to be national.
Thanks, man.
Well, my comment is they can solve all those issues with the employee. You know how the police pull you over, and before they get out the car, whoever that car is registered to, the picture of that person pop up on their computer. They can solve that just like they did the sugar tax. They upgrade their registers to compensate for the taxes or whatever. They can do that with every employer. Make them, if they hire anyone illegal, they need to charge the company $50,000 per year. Hurt them bad, and that way they'll stop it. You know? That's that simple to me.
Why does it seem like there is such... Why do I feel like there is an intersection between some of the things that this Trump guy says and black in the black community? You know, I think that there are times when there are commingled self-interest regardless of the person that you're talking to. Randall, you're on the talk of Chicago.
Hello?
Hello, hey Randall, yeah. You're on the talk of Chicago.
Okay, look, I support that, but also remember that breakthrough that was on the north side?
Say that again.
I said I support that, what it's doing. But anyway, remember that bakery that was on the north side that had about the ice? It had 800 jobs. They took 800 illegal aliens out of that place. With 800 jobs up there came open. So black folks could have had some of those jobs.
See, so do you think... I don't know if I could support ICE. I don't know if I could be telling. I don't know if I could be tricking, but I don't know if I would be standing in the street saying don't do it. I don't know, man. The Hood Corner Store, in my estimation, has not been a positive for us. And with it not being a positive, would you support them coming and checking it out, finding out what's going on? In behind, if you go to a Hood Corner store, and I've been to some of those stores, man, and I always say, something just ain't right. Would you take a look? But would you trick? I don't know if I would trick.
A lot is not right. There's no doubt about that.
But is the citizenship, citizenship status, the immigration status of the person owning or running the store. That's what ICE is about. That's what they're going to prosecute, and that's who they're going to detain or arrest. This other stuff, I don't know that they have any jurisdiction over.
Yeah.
They're going to come in and say, show me your papers.
I think, and we'll have to check that out. I don't know. We'll have to figure it out. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Top of Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas. When we come back, we're going to be talking to Casey Toner about police officers getting off of killing people in the suburbs. What's up with that? It's after Talk of Chicago, 1690.
The Talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation, 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.
A little early morning dusting of snow as temperatures...
All right, what you got out there? What up, Nia? What up, Amina? And keep crime going. What up, Celine? What up, Celine? Boy, no better way to instigate interracial hostility between fathers than shithole countries than one group to complicit with the ensuring the shithole status. You are so deep. What up, Kahinde? What up, Diane Scott? What up, Joe Wagner? What up, KM? KM said ICE can call in the ATF, who can call the FBI, CIA. Hey, man, I'm going to tell you like this. I got a guy who worked at who worked in, I don't say where he worked, but I got a guy who says that quite a bit of the things that happen in those stores finance things that go on against us, which is why they have these large, very large networks. I really could break down. Man, it's deep. It's deep. What up, DS? What up, Henry Hartsfield? What up, Alvin Norton? What up, Amina? What up, Denise? What up, Rod? What up, Celine? Black folks in Chicago facilitate draft raids to get ethnic whites into the military because the asses. See? That's what I'm saying, Celine. It, look, Dr. Adams was with me yesterday when she said, yes, she would support it, but it would also need to be a strategic plan to replace those stores immediately. I'm saying if people thought that they was going to have some ICE issues, we could probably buy them for cheap. What up, Renee Scott? What up, Kahinde? What up? Amina, you are so harsh. You said F them, uses ICE's bat to beat the hell out of them. We're always talking about slippery slopes and black people the only ones sliding. What up, Kahinde? Y'all are terrible. The dead, y'all eat everything. What up, Edward? What up, Sadiq? What up, Denise? What up, just shut the corner restaurants down all together and bring black soul food restaurants. I also think of illegal employment. What up, Marcus Jones? I think there is illegal immigration. Not even illegal immigration. You know, I would think like ICE would be able to cross-reference people that came from countries that were on their list. Like, maybe it's not that they don't have their papers. Maybe they say, hey, you got your papers, but you come from a place. It'll be interesting to see, man. What up, Andre? It's crazy to me, black. The people on the den, y'all just hate us, though, because y'all are over. Y'all be like, kill everything. What up, Alvin Norton? What up, KM? What up, Felicia? Felicia says, yes, raid the construction sites. Yes, raid the stores. Illegal activity going on in many of those stores anyway. The only thing I think, see, I think you could do a, what you could really do is do a joint task force, right? So you could use the ICE as the reason to go in, but you could do it like one of those combined teams. You know how they send in, like when they come get you, they hit you with the postal, they hit you with the ATF, they hit you with whatever they can find, right? Because then you can really get them on the tax fraud too with them illegal cigarettes. I think it'd be real interesting. What up? And I think that if you knew it was happening, right? Like what made them go to 7-Eleven, right? Ain't them the same people? Sort of. It's like they did it for a reason. To send a signal, right? To send a signal to the people. Because I don't think it's so much when you talk about going after 7-Elevens. I don't think that Donald Trump is saying... I think Donald Trump has been trying to make the connection between these countries and terrorism. So I don't think that if he went into those places and there's been a history of money, like you could use the old story of them sending food stamp money back. He'll use whatever narrative to say, hey man, these people are supporting terrorism. Enemy of my enemy is my friend. I'm not suggesting that I want it to be, but I'm just saying it's a way you could look at it. What up, Amina? Yep, I got my papers. Could care less. Right. You pull out your social security card, the police don't stop shooting your ass. What up, KM? What up? Loose cigarettes being sold at gas stations. Black kids are stealing cell phones downtown and bringing them back to those stores. Man, and they sending them where? Across the seas. Here we go with these damn construction. Why can't both sides be raided? They can all be raided. Send them to camp. Damn, send them to camp. Fuck them. Y'all are terrible. How about if ATF comes in and cleans them up? How about that? Andre Smith, if we don't have to be careful, raid them all, and I'm sure they'll discover other illegal activity. Damn. Good morning, Maze Child, Sonya Lyon, Dan Happy, Black on Black Love Family. The new face you make when you always been Jack but never been in the box. Hey, child, Sam's Club is closing a bunch of stores. Expect property taxes to go up even more now in Madison. Damn. That's crazy. What up, Frank? What up, Frank Thomas? How you feeling, brother? What up, WJ? What up, Sheila Mojo Kellogg, Ron Lewis? Can y'all do me a favor? Take a moment. Share the broadcast. share the broadcast. I need the weekend. I need a feel like going on. What's up, YouTube? I'm practicing looking at y'all every once in a while. I'm getting my cues. Hello, hello, hi, YouTube. You know what? The way YouTube is set up right now is because it's coming through, not live stream, it's coming through Switcher. So I can't see any of the comments or anything, but what's up, YouTube? I should switch y'all to what's up? Can you take a moment, share the broadcast? What's up? Yeah, that is true. He is going for low-hanging fruit. I'm saying, like, I think he did the 7-Elevens because more people watch Simpsons than anything. I'm telling you. Like, that dude is he using pop culture, man. What up, Sheldon Watts? I'm going to try. Oh, Daryl, how is Johanna doing? I'll give you an update. But you can go follow Johanna Leah on Instagram, and you can see the updates on her surgery. Hi, Antonio. Sadiq. You are tuned in to the Talk Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Gotta say what's up to Annette Flournoy in the newsroom, as well as Miss Sonia Escobar. Charles, you know it's a TV behind you. And behind you, I keep seeing that word. And I'm wondering, what is going to happen when the kids wake up today? Are we going to have to beat our kids? Because you're going to have to send your grandkids a note to say, just because you've seen it on TV, you don't get to say it.
Well, you know, the thing is, too, I noticed that last night on Fox News, they weren't using the S word. They weren't putting that part of it on because obviously they are trying to, I guess, mitigate the damage that's happening right now. But CNN, man, they are all over, like you're watching right now, they are all over it, man. They're saying it, printing it, writing it, everything.
Do you think it's going to make the lexicon this year? Like, do you think it'll be like, you know, at the end of the year?
And you know why?
Because he's going to have another one.
Because next week, Trump going to do something more outrageous than this.
Right. What about Fire and Fury, man?
What about Fire and Fury? What about Omarosa storming off? What about, you know, any of this Bannon? What about any of it?
Hey, man. Look.
This guy, he's talking to himself.
He controls the media.
You know, I'm really wondering if, you know, they talked about his mental state, and I was like giving him a play. Say, you amateur psychiatrist, you don't know. Man, has he lost his filter? Has he lost his mind?
I don't think he lost his filter, man. I think he is a master of distraction, a master of illusion.
Why would he do that? That wasn't
you. Ain't talking about him being crazy. Well, you are.
I'm beginning to wonder, and I'm gonna tell you. 24 hours ago, I would have took that crazy talk and said, "Hey, stop! You all don't know what you're talking about." Now, why would he do that? Why? What possible benefit? Even if he thought it, I mean, I've always known or thought. But now he's saying it?
Man, Charles.
Then talk about people from Norway? We need more people from Norway. In other words, we need more white folks.
We need more blonde-haired, blue-eyed...
Yeah.
Devils. They blonde-haired, blue-eyed angels.
Yeah, from Norway.
Satan. God. You know what? And then, that's kind of crazy. But you want to know what's even crazier, Charles? You want to know what's even crazier? What would you say if I told you with all of this talk of police reform in Chicago that there have been over 113 police shootings in the suburbs and not one police officer has ever been disciplined? Not even disciplined. How is that possible? Charles, we're going to talk to Casey Toner of the BGA. He wrote a story called Taking Cover, How Suburban Cops Escape Discipline for Shootings in Suburban Chicago. Casey, welcome to the WVON Morning Show. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me on.
All right. So, Casey, tell us about this story and what you found.
Well, we found that going back to 2005, we found that there were more than 113 shoots in suburban Chicago. And like you were saying, out of 113 shoots, not a single officer was disciplined, fired, or charged with the crime of any of these shoots. And we found some shoots that raised serious, serious questions.
Like, give me some examples.
There was one case where in South Suburban Robbins, there was a fight that broke out over a rim that was being stolen off a car. And an officer showed up, and he claimed he saw some man with a weapon, so he fired his gun at him. And one of the bullets hit a 13-year-old boy in the lower back who was standing on his aunt's porch.
Wow. Hmm. Now, what accounts for the lack of prosecution or even discipline?
Well, the prosecution is one thing, because given the way our legal system is set up, it's very, very hard to charge, let alone convict, an officer. But the discipline is a little bit easier issue, because that's something where, you know, departments can do it, really, if they want to or they need to. But in this case, it's a matter of they're not really looking into these shootings correctly. Like in Chicago, for example, if an officer shoots someone, there's an investigation into the criminal actions, whether that constitutes a crime. And then there's also an investigation into, you know, whether that officer should have used his taser, or he should have called for backup, or he should have done all these other procedural issues. And that is just not getting done in the suburbs. Departments are just not analyzing these shoots for best practices and policies.
Now, Casey, let me allow you to analyze these shoots. How many of these 113 victims were black?
We found that two-thirds of the victims were black, and a total of about 80% were minorities.
Now, So let me ask you another question, Casey. You know, we were talking about this. Have you heard this conversation about strategic gentrification that's been going on?
Yes.
Okay. Do you think that this strategic gentrification has anything to do with these shootings? And let me explain. The South suburbs are now one of the places that the former residents of CHA were replaced with or were sent to. And those suburbs have rapidly converted from white suburbs to black suburbs or minority suburbs with still those white police forces. Do you think that plays any factor in that?
Well, one thing we do mention in our stories, we do mention this gentrification that has occurred in the South suburbs over the course of the 40 years. But one thing that we did find that was interesting is that in many of these communities, many of the officers involved are black. One of the bigger problems overall is that a lot of these suburbs, they just don't have enough money to pay, retain, and even hire the best of the best police officers.
So wait, you're saying that they hire, what are you, wait, go back. You're saying that they can't hire good police officers?
I'm saying that in order to run a quality police department, you really need to be ordered. You really need to have to be able to pay them. And there are some of these towns that are running every year, they're running multi-million dollar budget deficits. And the experts we spoke to, they said that one of the things that's first to go when you can't pay your bills is a quality police department. And in the case I mentioned earlier in Robbins, where that little boy was shot in the back, he was shot by an officer who was part-time and who was making about $10 an hour. And so ask yourself, you know, who can you pay to patrol the streets of Robbins for $10 an hour?
Hey, Casey, did you find, in your research, did you find any instances where officers who had been disciplined, even in Chicago, and got hired in a suburban department and ended up involved in a bad shooting or a shooting?
Yes, we profiled an officer in Dalton named Major Coleman, who over the course of his 20-year career has been involved in 6 shootings.
Wow.
And his first shooting, he was working off duty at a Dominick's in Chicago when he was a Cook County sheriff, and he fired 2 bullets at some guy that was running away with a can of baby formula that he stole. And for that, he was disciplined by the Cook County sheriff for 2 weeks. He was suspended for 2 weeks. And that was the last time he's been disciplined. But after he left the sheriff's office, he went to South Holland, where over a matter of a few months, he was fired, and then he took a job in Dalton. And in Dalton, he's had multiple shoots. And these shoots raise serious questions. I mean, there was one shoot where he was the passenger in a police chase that was going 100 miles an hour, and he leaned out the passenger car window and shot a hail of bullets into the tires of a guy that was fleeing. And you know, those are not the types of things they train you in the police academy.
This guy's still working.
He is still working.
Oh, Casey, we're going to talk about that when we come back. It's Talk Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Charles Thomas will be back.
More of the morning show.
That's crazy. Maze Jackson coming I'm going to tell you, though.
That's some crazy shit.
I don't mess around with them suburban cops.
Oh, hell to
them. Let me tell you what. I do not mess around with suburban cops, because suburban cops, they will kill you, because they are making $10 an hour. And there is no, y'all don't mess around with them suburban cops at all. As a matter of fact, remember they used to pass out badges. You could buy you a badge and be a suburban cop back in the day. All right, y'all, let's Talk Chicago 1690 AM. I'm gone, Charles. You got the camera, my man.
Yeah. Now, that's a lot of cops, bad cops. In fact, a lot of bad cops in Chicago end up in the suburbs. It's all over. I mean, and it's not just in black suburbs, it's in north suburbs, west suburbs, you name it. Because once you go through the training academy in Chicago, that sort of gives you the certification you need to get a job anywhere. So you go through the training academy, become a cop in Chicago, at that point you can pretty much take that certification anywhere you want around the area, and they'll say that you're trained and that you can be a cop. And if in Chicago, and we've talked about this a lot, where the discipline process is so slow and so ineffective because of the police union contract, you could actually begin the disciplinary process in Chicago, be involved in it, see that you're going to get fired or it's going to go on your record, then quit so that the process stops and you're still clean, huh? Go get yourself a job in a suburb, which will overlook it because, you know, they're all cops and they sort of, they do hang with each other and protect each other. And then suddenly you've got a bad shoot in the city or some kind of violation in the city, and you're working in Addison, or you're working in Robbins, or you're working in South Holland, or Homewood, or some suburb, and you're a bad, you know, you're a cop with some issues, and your issues never really were brought to the surface. That happens all the time. I mean, it really does. I mean, you'd be surprised at the number of cops who retire with full pensions from Chicago and go get themselves a job in the suburb. Particularly a lot of command level cops. They'll leave Chicago and get a pension and then go be the police chief in a suburb. That happens over and over and over again. In fact, very few command level cops retire and just go fishing. A lot of them see the opportunity. They can go make a six-figure salary in the suburbs while they're collecting a pension in the city. So the city trains the city, which has this horrific reputation, national, international reputation for police abuse, is feeding cops all over to the suburbs. Amazing. Yep, they go to work for universities. As Carol Muhammad points out, they go to work for a lot of colleges. There's a lot of police departments out there. In fact, every college and university has a police department.
And they have jurisdiction. They have jurisdiction. Yeah, I know about the university police very well. Yo, yo, I shot the sheriff. All around my own town, they trying to track me down. Well, to bring me in guilty, but they're chilling beauty. For the killing of a deputy. Oh, not now. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas. And we are talking to Casey Turner. Now, that song says, I shot the sheriff. But it seems like the sheriff is doing the shooting. Casey Turner. What is going on? So, Charles, you asked a question before we went to break about this police officer, and was he still working?
Yeah.
Now, wait, go back and rewind our listeners and let them know we are talking to Casey Turner, and he wrote a story about how police officers get to kill people in the suburbs, shoot people in the suburbs, and get away with it. Casey, so these cops are still working? This officer, tell us the story again. He did what?
Yes, there's an officer right now who's working in South Suburban Dalton, and he, over the course of his 20-year career, has been involved in 6 shootings. And the earliest came when he was working as a sheriff in the late 90s, as a Cook County Sheriff's Officer in the late 90s. And he fired 2 bullets at this man who was fleeing, who stole a can of baby formula from a Dominick's. And he was suspended for 2 weeks from that. And that was the last time he was disciplined or suspended at all for any of his shootings. And we found that he eventually left to take a job in South Holland as a police officer, but he was fired after a few months. And then days later, he joined the Dalton Department, where he's been involved in a handful of shootings, including one shooting where he leaned out the passenger side window of a police car during a 100-mile-an-hour police chase and fired a handful of bullets at the tires of this fleeing vehicle. And from all the experts we've talked to, that is not something that is taught to recruits in the training centers.
Casey, you say this cop is still working. What is his name? Is he black or white?
He is black, and his name is Major Coleman III.
So let me ask a question. How does a cop like that get hired? I mean, is that on your resume? Is there a record that follows you that says, this guy likes to shoot people? Don't hire? Is there a do not hire list?
Well, I mentioned earlier that there is an issue with a lot of these underfunded departments where they don't have the money to train, retain, and even hire the best of the best. And it happens again and again in these many of these towns in the south suburbs and the west suburbs, where there are police officers with checkered backgrounds that just manage to escape and you know, get hired and patrol the streets. And you know, with Major Coleman, he did get hired, and he's been involved in a number of a few shootings. And that shoot where he was on the expressway, you know, blasting out the tires in his high-speed chase, you know, that's just one. There's other cases. There's a case where he shot this young man in the back on New Year. There's another case where he was involved in a shooting where one of the bullets, you know, broke out the kitchen window of this lady's home that was sleeping at the time. So it's a very serious issue.
I'm sitting here with my mouth open.
Yeah, I know, man. Let's be clear. Major Coleman.
Hey, Charles, don't be calling him out, man, because
I'm through Dalton. I'm saying, though, he's not a major. That's his name, Major.
Or is that his title?
He's a patrolman. He's not a, yeah.
So let me just say this. Patrolman. Look. I don't want no problems, right? Like, I got to go. You know, sometimes I drive through Dalton and go look at that billboard we got. So I don't want no problems.
Because if he don't like it,
you can tell us. No. Look, you see, I didn't even want to know no names. I don't want to know no names. I got my own problems, right? And all I need, you know, I'm already nervous. And you know how you had that sigh of relief when a black cop, well, you don't really have a sigh of relief. But when it's a white cop pull you over, you know he got the other guy on the other side with the pistol. I kind of take a sigh of relief when it's a black cop, kind of. So I ain't said nothing.
And then remember the legend of Two Gun Pete.
Woo-hoo-hoo! Two Gun Pete. So help me understand, Casey, what is being done about this? What are the local elected officials saying when they hear about these rogue cops? Are they rogue cops?
Well, part of the issue is that, you know, before our series, there wasn't any kind of, you know, deep analysis of this. And since it's come out, we've heard from a few people that have expressed interest in trying to change the system. Commissioner Richard Boykin, we quote in our story as supporting some kind of organization that will do these types of investigations after these shoots to determine, you know, was the officer following the best practices when he pulled the trigger? Because that's not being done right now. And some of these departments like Dalton and Harvey and Riverdale, you know, truthfully, I don't think that they have money necessarily to do these kind of comprehensive.
But I thought the state police did those investigations for those departments.
Well, there's a difference. The state police do the investigation of whether the officer committed a crime when he pulled the trigger. Mm. They don't look at whether the officer is doing the right thing when it comes to policing when he pulled this trigger. Mm. I mean, it's a slight distinction, but it's a big distinction.
Now, Casey, let me ask you a question. Is there a database? I thought that there was something that was passed in the state of Illinois that created a database when this Laquan thing happened that stopped cops from bouncing from municipality to municipality. That does not exist?
Yes. It's an interesting point you brought up because, well, first of all, for all these shoots, there is no public database for the suburbs until now, until we've built one, which can be seen on their website, that shows where they all happen, who was shot, and who the officers are involved. But the state of Illinois did create this database that was supposed to track these troubled officers so they wouldn't just bounce from department to department. But we found that the database is underutilized, to say the least. There's only 26 names of officers that were in that database, including none from Chicago. So all the officers that you've heard of in the past couple of years that have gotten fired from Chicago for you know, all sorts of reasons, none of them are on the list. So there's only 26. And of the 26, we found 10 of the officers that are on the list and then went on to get other jobs.
Boy, it seems to me like while we did all that hullabaloo about this Laquan McDonald and all the big stuff that's going on, it seems like we still have not fixed the issue. Look, we're going to have to come back to this. You know what? Our time got cut short on this one, Casey. But we want to talk about also this revolving door, which is what we were leading into, because I think that's a big problem as well, and it continues that culture. It's that, it seems like this is a continuation of the blue wall of silence, or the blue code of silence, in my estimation. Ladies and gentlemen, Casey Toner. Casey, how do you find, where can they find the story?
BetterGov.org, and the project is called Taking Cover.
Ladies and gentlemen, Casey Toner, Better Government Association. When we come back, looks like the Air Marshal Big O is in the studio, like the boss lady is calling in to tell us why WVON is in support of the Obama Library, unquestionably. I think we about to get in trouble, y'all. It's the Talk of Chicago, 1690. Big O, what's up, baby boy? Although I saw you on New Year.
Cloudy skies and temperatures climbing.
Man, how you doing, my brother?
Okay, so you gotta get the studio. So who's here? So then you need to, you know, you gonna hook us up?
God is good, isn't he? Yes, he is.
Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas.
So I just remember the shot, right? Yeah. We gotta move this monitor.
I got you.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Big O.
Talk to me.
We got to do this rugby thing, man. The dude keeps sweating me about it, and I keep saying I got him, and I ain't sent. No, I have all the stuff. Yeah. We gotta sit down.
All right. Yes, indeed. Let's see. I guess I can use these phones right here.
We'll get you set up.
So, man, are you an early riser?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm up at 5:30 at the gym. Then I go back, you know, take a shower, kind of lay around a little bit. Then about like 8:30. I start opening my book up and figure out what I need to do for the day. Yes. But yeah, I'm up at 5:30. Yeah. Now I didn't start that, because normally I wasn't up till 10:30.
Yeah, man, I get up early, man. You know, I get up then. I mean, not as early as I get up. But I'm about it. I try to wake up with the sun.
That's my wife. That's her. She started at 5:30 stuff. But I found it worked for me. Because I can get everything I need to get done before 12. And I got the whole day to do whatever I need to do. Yeah, so it works out very well. Oh, works out very well. Man, you know, I guess, and I heard y'all the tail end of it when I got in the car about the shithole. Is that boy a fool or what? Is he a fool?
I can't believe it, man. It's like, I can't believe it. I've never, and then, you know, we can talk.
You gotta believe it, but what I don't believe is, you got people trying to justify this shit.
Well, they're trying to justify it, but the thing is, there's not gonna be enough time to justify or to continue to criticize him for this, because he's going to do something next week that's going to be even more outrageous.
Because last week was the book.
Right.
Question of Insanity, which we knew he was crazy anyway.
Omarosa, there was that story. I can't even keep up with it, man. I can't keep up with all the stuff this guy does.
You said the key word. He is a master of distraction.
Yeah, that's what May said. Master of distraction, I guess, but I think the man is losing it. I really, I'm beginning to now to think that why you can do what you want to do, but why do you have to
do all that,
talking?
Yeah, all that.
Like Hitler didn't even tell anybody he was killing all them Jews, man. Yeah. He didn't tell anything. He just did it.
Exactly.
He did it. This guy, he got to talk shit constantly, man.
Well, that's his constantly. Ego. Huh? Yeah, he's egotistical. That's the ego part.
That's amazing,
him.
Man. I've never seen anything like it, man. And I'm telling you, man. This guy is making Barack Obama's legacy as president. He is making it just great. National. I'm not talking about his local situation.
Oh, Mike, come in. Go ahead.
What's up, my brother?
How you doing?
Doing okay?
I'm great.
Hey, guys. Good morning.
How are you?
Hi, how are you?
I work for Strat, I'm honest.
But what's the
The Obama Foundation.
Okay. Not one of the PR firms?
I do work for one of the PR firms.
What's that called?
SKDK Knickerbocker.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so we work with the Obama Foundation, yeah. And 100 years ago...
Your best bet is to stay out of the camera shot.
Oh, yeah, that is for
sure. Because you
don't want
to be in the camera shot.
No.
They're going to say that you're telling him what to say, and it's not. Right.
No.
They will do that. It's Facebook.
Yeah.
They will do that.
So you know you're live. Everybody knows that
just
you're...
Just get out of the camera shot.
Well, also, anyone who knows Strat knows that I can't tell what to say.
Yeah, don't tell him to tell you. I know that.
What's happening, man?
They will go crazy like
that. Sit over here.
All right.
I need you to scoot in. Big O.
Yeah, right here.
Man, Mike,
is
I need
cool?
you.
My aunt?
Yeah, all right. If I can get... Man, y'all done flooded me. So, Big O. I'm going to introduce you. You're going to chill on this one because we only got a half hour, and then we'll get into it. And then I think Melody is calling in as well. All right? All right, then. Here we go. Y'all are crazy. All right, y'all. Let's get it rocking. Obama Foundation is in the building. I'm going to tell you like I tell you all the time. My man, Strat Monis, back when I was a wild, rebellious undergrad, when you hear people talk about the old maze, that's like, you know, a lot of these disrespectful things that people be saying used to get you a mouth shot. Now, I just got smart something to say, right? Mike knew me back then. He knew me when I used to wear braids and cornrows, had my hat broke. Right? And they used to be like, young brother, this is college. And then you would see brothers like him and Preston, and they would be about their books and their studies. Right? Now Preston running for judge, right? Man. And you see these guys, and then you turn on the TV and you see like...
That's my boy.
Wait! That's my boy with President Obama. You know how you see it. And so, it's like I got this love-hate thing going on. Because I want to see my man... do well, and you know I'm still pissed off that he ain't the president of the foundation. You know what I'm saying? I'ma deal with that though. We're gonna deal with that. But in the meantime,
get this in here, okay?
Yeah.
Right here, you know, Albert the music.
This Monday, Mays Jackson.
You can, you know, customize it for you, but that's for the other hosts too.
The other hosts?
Are there
other hosts? I'm just playing.
To promote,
that's okay. I'm just playing. You know me. Anyway, y'all. So, this is the perfect convergence of how do we play the game, right? So my man is at the top of the pile, top. So we just gotta hold his feet to the fire. But you see, he ain't running, right? He come in and he sit down. But we got to make sure we get this bag. All right, let's do it. You bet. I don't believe in magic. I believe in love everlasting. You are tuned in to the Top of Chicago, 1690 AM, and boy, the studio done got lit up, packed, the phone lines done got hit up. It is the Top of Chicago, 1690 AM. This is the WVON Morning Show. I'm your host, Mays Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Wait, hold on. The Air Marshal is in the building, y'all. That's right. Big Otis Wilson is in the building. You know I got Annette Flournoy in the newsroom. Miss Sonia Escobar. Even Kate Burner is in the building. You know what I'm saying? It used to be one of my old, you know, we used to work together. So it's a big thing going on right now. But y'all, you know what? And on the live line, we got the boss lady. Now, let me tell y'all something. The way it usually works is we get a little phone, tired of coming here and say, y'all did it again. Right? And then we get a little note. But this week, Mike Strat Monis and Melody, we had some people on who are now the 51% holders of this Obama library contract. And we had some questions, tough questions. And I, you know, we try to be the lion. This is the lion's den, so we got to ask the questions the tough way. And I'm going to tell you, I don't know if they did a good job explaining, and they gave us more questions. But then, Charles, the phone rang. Hello? Mays Jackson, how you doing? Hi, boss lady. I just wanted to explain to you how this is one of the most important things that has come to Black Chicago, and we have fought to make it happen. And WVON is in 100% support of the library. And I said, but boss, did you hear the conversation? They told us a lot of things that we had heard before, and I need to know why this is different. And you know, she said, well, beyond the fact that it's my station.
Beyond the fact
that it's my station, let me tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to come in the Lion's Den, and I'm going to tell you why WVON, and you know, you at WVON, why WVON is going to be 100% in support of the Obama Library. So ladies and gentlemen, I think this might be a first for us. Hopefully it will be like the last when we ain't getting a whooping.
Somebody walked into the Lion's Den with a big old whip.
Right, a whip and a chair and said, are y'all going to sit y'all ass on that chair and sit still? Ladies and gentlemen, join us in welcoming the owner, the ringmaster, Miss Melody Spann-Cooper. Melody, welcome to the Talk of Chicago. Well, I gotta welcome you to your own joint. Thank you for welcome. Good morning.
Hey, you set it up so nicely. I don't know if I really need to be here. Mike Stratmass is here, and I mean, you said it. We are 100% in support of this library, have been since its inception, and with real reasons why. And I did not hear the conversation the other day. I heard different people call and say they didn't think the guys did a bad job. But what we all must understand is they are contractors. They're construction owners. They're not part of the media. They didn't come to put on a show or say things that they were unsure of. They came to VON first out of respect of the community, because it is a community station. And they said, hey, we have done something great. Something great is happening. And we're going to honor that. I mean, the station is going to honor that. And I just wanted to come on because one of the things that happens, I feel, and Mike Stratmanis can speak on behalf of the library. He does it so well. He's head of civic engagement. But as head of this radio station,
this
is huge for our community. And it's not going to be easy. It's not going to be perfect. But we're going to support this process. We're not going to divide. We can hold people accountable. But we are going to respectfully doing it, understanding that there is one mission here, and that is forward. We're going forward. And I'm so excited about it. We do a lot of work. As many of you know, I'm a co-chair of the Inclusion Council. So we're fighting for equity and parity for various communities as part of this process.
But boss,
there's always, let me finish. There's always dissension. There can be questions. We don't mind that at all. We expect it. We welcome it. One of the things that we wanted to do from the beginning and has always been a part of what we're doing with the center is we said transparency, because we know this is transforming for the community. And so Mike's out often. Anytime we need to go out, we're out. There's various community meetings. There's so much openness around this. And everybody is not going to be happy. We have a voice there for them. But we will not act in dissension. I'm not saying that we are, but I'm coming on as the owner and the president of VON and letting everybody know we can disagree without being disagreeable. There will be not any hidden agendas here. We're going to move forward as we build something that will transform the South Side of Chicago.
Melody,
it's
Charles. Good morning.
Hey, Charles.
Good morning. Thank you for the opportunity that you've given me to speak on this medium. But I got a question that I got to ask.
Okay.
Because right in the middle of this process, a candidate for governor has dropped into the conversation the idea that there is a
conspiracy, a strategic move, a plan to gentrify, to push black people out of the city of Chicago. And many critics of this project are saying that this project is part and parcel of that effort. As a community leader, I wanted you to respond to that notion from Chris Kennedy.
Well, I don't like to really get involved in politics.
But this is politics.
That's okay, Charles, let me say this. I don't want to politicize the Obama Library in terms of an overall, you know, some kind of conspiracy to move black people out of Chicago. That may be the case, but the Obama Library Center has nothing to do with it. Mm-hmm. Anytime the first African-American president of the United States gets bold enough to take his library to the south side of Chicago, that's bold. And I don't think he's doing it. I haven't talked to him about it, but I think I know him well enough to know that that is not the goal. If anything, the goal is to help preserve and sustain our community. And you know what? I think we spend a lot of time worrying about what everybody else wants to do in our community. We own Woodlawn. We live in Englewood. We live in these communities. So I don't really get caught up. It's on us to decide what is going to be the fate of these communities and to these communities. And when you get a $1 billion gift, when you've got somebody willing to invest $1 billion on the south side of Chicago, I don't think you should kick a gift horse in its mouth. Furthermore, and because I can't stay as long as Mike Stratman is can, you know, Reverend is being honored today at the Interfaith Breakfast. And so I wanted to go and pay homage to him. But let me say this about this contract with these dynamic, best-in-class contractors, Maimon Powers, who's been in this community over 50 years. He's got a legacy business. When you talk about people like Ernest Brown, who's done phenomenal work, and when you find a creative way to give them the majority of the contract, I don't know that you can find something wrong with that. See, we can challenge people on, oh, well, you know, they don't give enough jobs to black folks. Ain't nobody called Turner to the VON and said, Mr. Turner, you're building downtown this $500 million, whatever it is, and you've got TIF monies to do it. How many black people are you going to hire? I've never seen Kenny come up in VON and sit down and have a conversation with us, and he's challenged on the way that they're doing it. So, hey, I love the fact, I love the Lions Den. I love being in it. I do. I think people should be held accountable. And I'm not saying that there should be any accountability. Not the president does not think that it's not going to be. Marty Nesbitt doesn't think. Mike Stratmanis. Any of the people there is not saying that there should not be an accountability. But what I am saying from this radio station is we're going to move forward. We can, you know, we can ask questions, but we are supporting this library. The city needs this library. It needs it. It just does not want it. We need it in these areas. And it will bring about, it will become an economic engine. There will be employment for individuals. I had an opportunity to sit down with the president. He came in about 6 weeks ago. And he was so dynamic in making sure that everybody in his staff knew the direction of this as it begins to take off. And the one word that he left me with, guys, was he said, I want you to overwhelm me with opportunities for people. I want you to overwhelm me. That's strong. That's strong language. And he used it so that everybody on his staff knew exactly what he wants to take place. It's there for us. It's there for the world. I mean, we can't make him small. This is the president of the United States, something none of us thought we'd ever see in our lifetime. But we're going to deliver this with him and for the city of Chicago. We'll all get on the same page on this. Not saying you can't criticize it. We're going to change our energy around it so that it becomes something dynamic for the city and the world. And that's the only thing I wanted to share with you all today.
The only thing? that was very passionate. But that was a passionate, passionate appeal.
It's a passionate appeal.
I'm passionate about it.
Hey, man. You should have heard the passionate phone call.
May, let me say this. One last thing that I saw, and I want you all to think about. one of the greatest things, earlier this year, I was in Cincinnati for business, and I was going somewhere else. I had to connect back in Atlanta. I hadn't been in Atlanta for 12 years. Okay? And I wasn't going then. I just landed at the airport. It made me cry to see all of those black folks in Atlanta working. You go to Midway, you go to here, you go to anywhere in Chicago. We're not working. I go to some places in this country. I cannot believe the amount of us working. Houston, working. Dallas, working. We're not working, right? We're not working. And one of the reasons why Atlanta is working the way that it is, in that airport, is because Mayor Jackson decided he was going to do something revolutionary. The people that built that that airport, mostly were African American. People got very rich dealing with that that airport. And years later, they're reaping the benefits. Now, I'm not saying that the Obama Library is, you know, like I said, it's the international library that's happened to land on the south side of Chicago. We are going to figure that out. We're going to figure this out because we need that kind of economic engine on our side of town. And we don't need anybody to come deliver it for us. It's right there, folks. It's right there. So let's figure this out. Let's get this done. Let's get it done harmoniously. We can fight behind closed doors. Let's not get in the streets and embarrass this president and embarrass ourselves when we've been given this kind of opportunity.
Ladies and gentlemen, that is the president, CEO, chairman of the board, boss of the, she got the whip and the chair. That is Melody Spann-Cooper. Now, when we come back, we're going to continue our conversation. We got Mike Strap-Minus in the building. We're going to take your calls. But the other thing I just want to say is that, guys, there is, and I want to make sure that everybody's clear, understand that this, I believe this library can be a good thing, but there's just so many years of mistrust built up, and people just feel like, man, is this going to be more of the same? And so, you know, I can be optimistic, and I think that when you brought up that the Jews don't get out and whack each other in public and the Italians don't get out and whack each other in public, that is something. I think there is just an issue here locally with people feeling like the people that they've put to the front to represent them have not done a good job. And so we got to figure out how we overcome that. It's the Talk of Chicago, 1690. We'll be back, 752.
More of the Morning Show with Mays Jackson coming up.
Woo!
Man, I don't know why they sent you here.
I know, you about to say. Because we got questions.
Go on, man. Yeah.
We got questions.
Get yourself
and
a sausage muffin, man. I was ready to be passionate on that.
Man. I mean, you think she was passionate on that one. You should have been on the phone call because it was a little less passionate and a little more direct. But I think the key here is this, right? And I think the one thing is, because I don't think that even in our conversation on the phone, she wasn't like, you don't question it. Man, just how do you question it and how you gonna do it? I do think there is something to the fact that Jewish people don't lambast each other in public, that Irish don't lambast each other in public, that we do. But I think it is because in so many cases, those communities don't feel like they've been let down by the people who have been put in front of them.
Yeah.
So now here you come, and Mike, you gotta recognize in Chicago, man, real talk. Like, everybody loves the president from the Hope Change and all that crap, but like when we look at the city, right, it didn't feel like we got nothing. I'm talking to you direct. Like, it does not feel like there was an advance. There feels like there was, you heard about the third bathroom, you heard about protecting the dreamers, you heard about, and then we get, he would have looked, Trayvon would have looked like me if he sang Amazing Grace instead of Fight the Power, right? Like, you know, and so in all of those hopes and dreams that it seems like always, the black president wins. The black elected official that wins the mass market is convinced that he has to ignore black people because you got them, but you can't let the white folks think you too black. And then we spent 4 years saying, man, he can't do it because you know they're going to get at him.
Right.
Then the second 4 years, we like, damn, what's up?
Wait. Only thing I would say about that is,
tea party.
That's what it sounds like.
Pretty much slow approaching Halstead. you know, other supporters, they knew that, you know, healthcare, tax reform, criminal justice reform, you know, it was clear to in the national conversation.
No, don't change, because you got to hear what we're talking
about. What we was about.
You better be cool, Tina. You better stop tripping.
People.
Hey, man, it's going. The deck
is losing his people.
Man, we all losing people around here. They going crazy, man. These phones are going crazy, man. It's, hey, yo, I'm just saying. Y'all, it's like there's a different perception here. And I'm saying, Mike, it's like, I keep telling you, you my man.
Oh, I'm going to dress it straight. I'm going to dress it straight up.
Because it's like, man, y'all got the cameras.
Now, you know, you look at the highest black unemployment rate in the country. You look at this, more homicides than New York and LA combined. You look at the school situation, and you know, it's just very, very difficult to reconcile.
I see.
You know, the black president, but nationally, it's a different story. It's a different story nationally. I mean, particularly now, when you look at what I mean, Obama's presidency, man, has been elevated by Trump. I mean, but it's crazy too to think that we're the community that birthed him has such issues. I mean, I don't know how that happened, but those numbers don't lie.
I know how it happened.
Well,
perception, bro. It's like the fact.
Wait a minute. Here's one of the things.
Move that mic. Hey, y'all. Look, check this out, though. Dan, you getting. Move the mic to the side just a little bit so they can see your face. You getting. This dude was like top legal counsel. He was right there. Go ahead, Mike.
So, we already had unemployment, people hanging on. When the recession hit, our community was not in a position to be able to survive that. And so one of the things that I'm proudest of is President Obama went through all kinds of changes to focus on that economy day one.
Can you stay?
Yeah, I'm here.
All right.
Am I good? 10 to 15? Okay, yeah, 10 to 15.
Say again?
10 to 15.
So they like, cut it! They like, cut this! Cut it! She looking at the... I know, man. Oh, man.
Chicago,
you got to come on the podcast.
Chicago traffic.
You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago 1698. Boy, are you what, Mike? You at the union party, man? Are you doing
it? I met my wife, this beautiful sister, at an Illini union party.
Good Lord, man. You That's know true. We go away. Mike, you're making it hard for me, man. Now, for those of you all who don't know, the boss lady just came down and threw down the gauntlet. WVON is now 100% in support of the Obama Library. And that's my story. I'm sticking to it. But Mike Strap-Minus is here. He is the Director of Civic Engagement for the Obama Foundation. Mike, I got to get to the root of this issue, because I think that the library could be a great thing. But there is so much distrust in Chicago of the people, whether from our elected officials to the University of Chicago to all the people that are the big players in this, that there's just a level of suspicion and a level of just like, we don't want it.
Right.
You know what? They're giving me the sign that says I gotta go to break. When we come back, she talked the 30 minutes. It's break time. So we're gonna go to break. We're gonna come back. And then Mike, you looking at me like, man, if the time is up. The time is up. She talked 40 minutes on the break. Mike, when we come back, I want you to address the issue of the mistrust that the community feels, and do you feel like you can understand why there is such pushback against what could be the biggest thing happening? Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Talk of Chicago 1690-759. We'll be back after news, traffic, and weather.
the talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation.
I mean, it's like sometimes it's hard not to react. It's like I'm talking and I'm trying to get, you know, you and somebody does something. You like, what? What's the problem?
So I just came out of a commercial. I just said, what happened?
Oh, we came out of a commercial. She talked. No, she talked. No, no, I'm not. Oh, no, I'm not tripping. No, but I'm saying she talked the clock. She talked 35 minutes. And then left 2 minute commercial. We came back. Yeah. We only had 2 minutes in the break.
I wasn't paying attention. So
that's the boss.
Boss, yeah. Do what they want to do.
That is the boss. But she's been, you know, she's been helpful, man.
Man, I think,
you know, she's obviously, if she's gonna do that, it means that when she's talking to us, you know, she's strong. She's holding us accountable because she's not gonna put herself out here like that. And then at the end of the day, things aren't right. So it's helpful having her here. And you know, just from being a business owner, she has a very practical take on things. There's not a lot of rhetoric. She's, as you know, very straightforward.
But when they come and tell us, man, that there aren't any black people that could get these jobs, that we can't do, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm going to say this. I feel like we got way too much focus on construction, because if you look at the NACS code, I mean, we're not there. That's not, to me, what are we doing to build the long-term sustainability? How do we operate? How do we get those businesses that are going to benefit from all of the tourism? Are we training people now to own restaurants? Can we take out the J&J Fishes? Can we take out the such and such bar places and, like, I could see it if we didn't work. See, I feel like we're just talking so much about construction. And because we know we're going to get jammed in a construction deal.
We are talking about construction now, but that is because we have to take this thing step by step, right? And everything that is done has to be done A+. So I have to take, we have to take the time to do the construction thing, right? Because that's what's first coming down the pike. And if that's not right, you know what they say, right? If you can't do, you know, the straightforward things right, which we think this has to be done, then how can you do whatever else is? And so what I don't want to have happen is, while we have our focus on things that will be important in 2021, 2022, when this thing opens, that we don't build infrastructure. And by the way, that kind of thing will give people confidence. What I want to do is, for example, have a Obama Foundation job fair. The people who come to those doors, and multiple ones, the people who come through those doors, not all of them will be interested in construction, ready for construction. And so I need to basically have them captured so that I can put them into job training programs or other things so that they can be ready to do other things until the center opens. So,
so Mike,
that's the focus, yes.
Again, yes. Right? The language, and you gotta understand, man, we've been here. So I did the Dan Ryan Reconstruction Project.
Right.
And in doing the Dan Ryan Reconstruction Project, that's kind of the same thing that we were told then, right? Which is, we gotta get these people, we gotta put them in a training program, we gotta get them worked to ready.
No, I'm not talking about that.
Okay.
I'm not talking about that. What you're talking about is basically pre-apprentice programs and the things that people need to be put through so that they can be prepared to be on a construction site, right? That is its own separate deal. And we have to hold people accountable around that. And by the way, the Obama Foundation is not only put in the construction manager, we're putting in an entire separate program together with our own dollars to support these construction managers so that they are able to do, able to get people in for those jobs. So we're not just relying on them. We don't just have penalties in the contract if they don't do it. We're putting our own program together. What I'm talking about is people who come through those doors who should be involved in technology. Or maybe we help someone create a business so that they can do lawn care.
Who's black doing communication?
Right? Who is black doing communications? So we got Sleep, we got Des Tate, we got
who you got that can talk to the people?
I got Sleep. I got, you mean who's doing
me? I ain't gonna hate on Sleep. I got Sleep. I'll give Sleep. I let sleep be. We go, see, but let me. You know what? But that's, man, when I'm going to get invited to one of them cool breakfasts, man, I'm telling you. Y'all got to see my man. I'm going to tell you where he has his breakfasts. But he has these breakfasts. And I'm just going to tell you whether we agree. That's still going to be my man. My friends are my friends regardless. I don't play that. But anyway, you got to see him because he got this cool pose where he be like, I be like, what you Tribe Called Quest, man? It's like, see, Mike wasn't like a gangster rapper. Like, he was listening to that intellectual like rap back in the day. I hate Tribe Called Quest, just for the record.
Farside.
I like Farside because I got that voice.
He's on pass.
Me, bye. Hey, y'all. You know what, Mike? I do want to say, man.
What's up?
I'm upset I couldn't get an invite to the party, man, because I heard Snoop smoked in the White House. Did y'all know?
On that one, I'm silent, and I will always be silent.
Hey, let me ask a question. On the last day of the Obama administration, did y'all roll one up and just be like,
you know what I told him to do? You know what I told him to do on the last day? I told him you got to take that white light out, you put that red light in, and all you want to hear in midnight is, just have the bass. just shake the windows.
Mike, did y'all barbecue at the White House?
We didn't cook out at the White House.
If you circle back to this after 8:30, he's been having some rough bowel movements this morning. 6 tweets.
Okay. Hey,
I need to. What's my?
What's coming back?
You can say it.
Okay. Good. All right. Cool.
Mike, say. You know what I'm saying? It's like he ain't do it. Kate,
what up?
You like Big Willie now.
Yeah.
Like big time.
I'm just chasing around town.
I told, you know what, it's funny. We were on a campaign trail, right, for Pat Quinn. And I used to be like, who is this little chick that just is just intolerable? But I was like, you know what, one day she is going to be something. Freaking 8 years later, she like, man, Joe, I'm telling you. See? But we need a program like that for black people.
Man, he's like,
right? How do you do that in 8 years?
So we did it, man.
How do you do that?
Obama started that in the
How long is yoga, man? It's my yoga time.
Uh-oh, it's now yoga time.
Up, y'all messing my flex.
That's nonsense.
Look at that. You're getting some love now. You are tuned in to the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Maze Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building. Y'all, I got the Air Marshal, Otis Wilson, in the building. Look at that, Super Bowl champ, man. Super Bowl champ. And check this out. You know we can't do the morning show without saying what's up to the team at every top of the hour. Now, you know you can catch me getting my stretch on. Check this out, though, y'all. We got an Obama VP in here getting his yoga on.
What's up?
Mr. Mike Strapmanis. Now, we got to say what's up to the WVON Morning Show team. What's up to Annette Flournoy in the newsroom? You know we can't fly this thing without the musical conductor of the Soul Plane, Miss Sonia Escobar, my main man, Charles Thomas, Air Marshal Otis Wilson. But like I told y'all, Mike Strapmanis, Obama Foundation in the building. Mike.
Maze, what's happening?
She is a generational distrust, man. Seems like we're trying to, and there's a level of mistrust that has existed over years because we've heard so many of these things before. Mike, what is going to be different?
Well, the first thing that's going to be different about this is that, one, this project, this Obama Presidential Center, is happening. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to come here and talk about the milestone that we reached to go ahead and close out these designs. You know, we got this design thing to the point
where we are
ready to file this with the city. Now, and what that means is that this multi-million dollar, hundreds of millions of dollars of investment in the South Side of Chicago is one more step closer to reality, because one of the things that's happened in our community is there have been empty promises on this development. Projects have been talked about, but they haven't happened. You know, when I drove here this morning, I went down King Drive. And I went down King Drive because I wanted to see two things. I wanted to see the house I was born at over on 77th and King Drive. And I wanted to see Cole Park.
And Cole Park is where, when the, you know, my grandfather got tired of us, we were playing piggy and softball out on the street in the alley.
You played
and
piggy, man.
I played piggy. Piggy one, piggy two. And we were breaking windows, and the kid, and we were, you know, playing football and getting scraped up. They would bring us out to the park. And that park, it looks so small to me now, but it looked so big when I was a kid. And what's going to happen in 2021 or 2022, 2025, when this thing is open, it's going to open in 2021, is that we will have this beautiful park, gorgeous, invested in the Obama Center on the south side of Chicago for our families and for our kids to come and enjoy and appreciate. Like, that's what I'm excited about. Mike, this is happening.
Mike, I think a big question is, will black people be living around it and working around it and having businesses around it? That's what I think the big question is. And this thing with Kennedy certainly has, I mean, has to make your job more difficult.
It doesn't make my job more difficult because I work for Barack Obama, the first black mm-hmm. president of the United States, and Mrs. Michelle Obama, a sister who grew up in South Shore. Black people have been moving out of Woodlawn and South Shore for a decade because there hasn't been anything to keep gotcha. People there. The people okay. have been holding on, waiting for something real to happen to make this a destination with real investment. We want people to stay. We want people who moved out to Homewood, Flossmoor, or Dalton, or maybe they moved down to Hotlanta because they like to see all those people working at Maynard Jackson International Airport. We want them to say, we got to come back home. We got to come back home. We want them to be on the south side of Chicago because the south side of Chicago is what gave us Barack Obama because it is the epicenter of blackness and beauty in this country. That's what this center represents. And so, and how do you do that? How do you make that real? Well, the first thing you do is you make sure at every step of the way you are giving dollars in the pockets of black businesses so that they can hire our folks in the community. That's why more than half of our construction dollars are going to black businesses. And by the way, that is unprecedented. And how do you do that? Well, you don't do it by establishing some kind of, you know, putting a couple of community organizations, so-called, in front and making them gatekeepers. You do it through long, painstaking work, the listening that we've done, the outreach that we've done about what the okey-doke has been in this construction stuff. We listen to that, and so we've put together a construction manager project. That entire thing has been transparent. That's how we are going to get this done, because black businesses hire black people. I know that because I'm sitting in WVON where it's happened.
Ooh, and Mike, you sound like you a lawyer or something, like you pleading a case, man.
I'm just,
but you know what? Let me say this.
I got fired up when I drove by my home today. I just felt like, you know what? I have the chance.
So you're not one of these pencil neck geeks from Washington, D.C. that they done transplanted to tell us what's going on?
No, look, I'm from here. And listen, if you drive by there today, it looks in some ways much like it did when I grew up there. The problem is when you get out and you get in and you look in the neighbor's home, nobody lives there. When you walk around and you go into the businesses that used to be on 79th Street, where you could go to the roads, go to the show, go down and get some Funyuns from the corner, go and do that kind of thing. You know, that kind of thing is not there. We need to rebuild that. That has to start with investment. That's what the Obama Center represents.
I got two questions for you, Mike.
Yes.
You know, I give the President Obama the business. I give it to him. But Mike, how do you respond to a lot of our listeners who say, because you were right there, who say black Chicago didn't really get very yeah. much from Barack Obama, President Barack Obama?
Here's what I'd say to them. One, I would tell, and I know it's hard to talk about the absence of something, but I remember what it was like in 2008 when our economy collapsed and we were losing tens of thousands of jobs. Those jobs tore the heart out of this community. And so the one thing I would tell you is that when President Obama got in there and did what he did, and by the way, took a lot of flack for it and took a lot of opposition for it, to not only save this economy, but to make sure this economy was saved by investing in communities. We have health centers. We have economy worked. That economy saving worked, and that was for our people. The other thing I would say is that there has been no president who has tried to undo the damage caused by the drug war and through and the and that school to prison pipeline. There is no president who has done more on that than President Obama.
All right, I'm gonna let you skate on that one because that was a good one. I'm gonna let you get that one, Mike. But how do you respond to people saying that this is more of the Afrostocracy spreading the money amongst themselves, and we will see the same thing that we've always seen, which is the same names getting the money, enriching themselves, while saying they're doing it for the black community?
Well, I think the proof is going to have to be in the pudding on that. People are going to have to just see what happens. But one of the things I'd ask people to notice is what you have not seen is you have not seen the usual suspect lined up in front of some press conference. You know,
you
saying,
mean to tell me we ain't gonna have
this,
no?
This is, you know, this is what we're doing, and this is what we're going to do, right?
Where's your preacher brigade?
Because that is, those are commitments about what's going to happen. When we make commitments about what's happening, and you look at all, go to our website and just take a look at the little videos that we put out about what we're going to do and what this represents. We have Tanya Love Trice, who's at the who is with the South Shore Chamber of Commerce. We have my man Sean with the Dovetail Project, who's working on fatherhood. We have Emmanuel Pratt, who's getting his hands dirty, teaching young men who came out of prison how to build things and how to grow their own food. We have the woman Margaret Stoddard, who opened up Ain't She Sweet Cafe in Bronzeville. Those are the people that we're lifting up. Why? Because they are doing the actual work. That's what President Obama has been about. We want to lift up people who are rolling up their sleeves to make their communities a better place.
Mike, here's the deal, man. I feel like I still am, you know, I be smell testing. I feel like I'm suspicious of a lot of things, but I'm not suspicious of you personally. And so this is what I'm going to ask you, because I'm going to tell you, I'm getting ready to get my butt kicked for even letting you get on here and get off of here like this.
Yeah.
But what I want to do, Mike, is make sure that we have a line of communication, because I get a lot of feedback from the people who have been left out, been yes. screwed over, and have not had a vociferous advocate that can get them to the table. There are a lot of people that are doing things and that are not in the N Club, that ain't been to the BLC, ain't been to these, and don't have an advocate that probably could grow with this. And we want to make sure we get them an opportunity to.
Let's do that, man, because I think that what I don't want to have happen is I don't want people to be so cynical that they miss this.
That's my concern.
This is what I, because this is not, you know, maybe Mays, when you run for president, you can serve your 4 years and you can come back and we could have another black president build their presidential library in Chicago. But until that happens, this is all we got. And I need everybody to be a part of this. So, yes, let's do that.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to the Talk Chicago. When we come back, man, we got more topics to talk about. There's a lot going on. And we got Big O. Big O, what's going on with these bands? And this new coach, right? You got the Super Bowl champion, new bands. I know your people got to go, but Mike, why don't you stay and hang out with us? We can have a good time. It's the Talk Chicago, 1690 AM. I'm your host, Mays Jackson Charles Thomas. We'll be back.
More of the morning show.
Main challenge. Look, bro.
Sorry.
You got a lot of work to do, right? Yeah. And I think when I say you got a lot of work to do, you got years and years and years of the same old. And I caution you with the language,
yeah.
right? Because the language that you use is often the same language that people have heard, maybe not from the same person.
Yeah.
And so now they got to see it. And so if you say, I'm debundling, I got, and also remember,
yeah.
right? A lot of the names you put up,
I know.
They names are on stuff right now that we don't see. So when I drive around and I see those names on places, you got to recognize that sometimes the people you bring to the table also bring their baggage with you. Not to hate them, but just saying, like, everybody's got their own stack of people that they done dissed, pissed, whatever, And you gotta just make sure you know that you got the background on that too, because I bet a lot of the reason you're getting a lot of the pushback is some of the names have crisscrossed people, have screwed them over, etc. And so that's why they line up every time. And it's like, you've been gone, so you don't know. You come in, you like, man, you walk in, and if the Afrostocracy is feeding you all the information,
right,
you like, man, these are the people that I knew, or I know that are good people. And it's not a diss. I'm just saying, you got to get some people on the team that people care about, right? If you don't have, I always say to people, if you don't have nobody on the team that nobody cares about, then you're on your own. Who are the biggest, so like, you know who the issues are? Talk to them.
Well, give me some names. Put me on the podcast.
Man, the podcast is where we can sit down and just have a conversation. Okay. Kate.
I just want to clear something up really important for the room, because Mace called me intolerable.
No.
And when I came in on that campaign, you thought I was a fucking idiot, but by the time I left,
yes,
you loved me.
This was my homie, right? Yeah, you still didn't send me no White House invites. I want all, no. Kate, when we ended, Kate was my homie, was my girl, and so I'm going to expect that man.
Right.
Y'all gotta step up the communication. That's all.
Yeah.
All right.
Hey man, it's an honor.
Good to see you.
As always, good to see you.
Yeah.
Take care of yourself. But man, hopefully you'll be. You know, you make it always look like Lindsey Buckingham on that. What's up with that? You know, hopefully you gotta get on the air. I gotta send you that. You gotta go see
Black Panther.
Like,
yeah. I'm saying we need to connect the studio.
Because we'll maybe bring some students to go check it out or something.
That would be a good thing.
I'll follow up.
All right. All right. Man, hard work out here trying to balance, bro.
I'm here in this library, and I'm all for it, okay. You know. But what happens is, you put that library right where it's going to be. Everything around it that's black. Gonna get taxed out of there.
Well, see, my thing is, Big O, is we know that. So let's put all of that stuff in. So when they go in, when we talk to them the next time, you say, hey, we want to protect the tax base around here.
Right.
So what you gonna do? You gonna freeze? They do it with a TIF, right? We back. You are tuned in to the Talk Chicago 1698. I'm your host, Mace Jackson. Got my main man, Charles Thomas, in the building, as well as the Air Marshal is here, Big O. Big O!
What's happening?
Hey, man.
Good morning, man.
You know, you walked into the hornet's nest today.
Man, I've never been silent this much in my life.
Hey, Big O. Hey, man, I've been catching a whooping on social media. Everybody like, y'all being too nice. But, Big O, how... That's going to be $1 billion investment. My thing is, how do we get our piece?
Exactly. And that's what my concern is. I mean, I love the idea of having something, you know, Barack having his library here. But you generally what happens when you do something like that, you tax the poor people out of the community. And I'm wondering if they can put something in place where taxes are frozen, where they can stay in their community, really enjoy it.
See?
And make... I don't want to say, make the whole thing look black.
Right.
The whole area.
Big O, is it possible that we could possibly, instead of just being like victims one time, be the aggressors? Could we not be victims? Is it possible with $1 billion? Can I call my man Bob Israel up? Can I call him up and say, hey, Bob, if we ain't eating, we counting these numbers, it's not going down? Can we say that? Can black folks take control of our own community and not be a victim in this case?
I think to a certain point, you know, because there are some leaders and people in place that could help put that roadblock up there,
mm-hmm.
and bring some things in, but collectively, holistically, we don't get a big enough piece of the pie.
Man, you know,
pie is being cut up, we get that small slice. The slim fast slice.
We get the slim fast slice, and then it's somebody taking a slice and passing it out for us. Exactly. That ain't honestly brokering. Yeah,
exactly. So this thing's going to be done. It needs to be done fairly. And how you do that, I'm not really sure, because we don't sit at the table.
Well, let me say this. Mike Stratmiles, right? And I'm a go here right now real quick. And again, y'all know me. My friends are my friends. I don't change regardless of who they work for. Has always proven to be a stand-up person and been straight up. I think he's been gone for a while, right? 8 years away from Chicago. And, you know, when you're with the president, people do what you want. But I think that we are going to have to, I'm going to have to bring him up on the game of how Chicago works when you ain't the president. Like when you used to be the president and the president are two different things, man. Two different things. But I don't know if we, do we run the library away? How do we deal with it?
No, I don't think we run the library away, because that's something that, you know, is a legacy and we need it in our community. It's just that I hope it's not business as usual.
How do we not hope?
In college, I mean, you know, here in Chicago, keep working.
I think he was saying that we have to run to the presidential center and start to look for all kinds of opportunities to exploit this $1 billion investment that's coming into the community. For instance, if you want to buy a house, and maybe you have the money to buy a house.
Buy it now.
Buy it in Woodlawn. You know, buy it someplace around the library. If you want to start a business, I don't care if it's a coffee shop or whatever, start looking at areas near the presidential center. Black folks, there's an opportunity in your community. Don't let somebody else move in and take that opportunity. You seek it out. If you're thinking about getting involved in the construction trades, prepare yourself now to become a worker who can show up at that site and say, hey, I want to work here. Now, what you going to tell me? That I can't?
I would be out there with you. I'd be out there with you. I mean, and I would make it hard for white boys to pull up to work if we ain't working.
Right. And so, but he's saying that we have to run to this opportunity as opposed to being so disillusioned by what's happened in the past that we don't make an effort to run to an opportunity in our own community.
But can I say this though? 75% of our people are not set up to buy a lot of houses, to buy a lot of businesses. We have to prepare ourselves for that. And now how long that takes, I don't know.
Well, I'm suggesting, how about this, Cass? As we sit here and we talk about this thing, what are the financial, you know how they do TIFs, right? You know how they create these special homeowner programs, right? I think we had the people from the Cook County Land Bank that did a big program of where you could buy in Woodlawn, really, which was in the area, and I think they sold out. People took advantage of it. But you know how when the Olympics was coming and people were buying homes and buying property with the anticipation that we would get the Olympics? Mm-hmm. Do we as black folks take this opportunity? Now, I don't want the fight to always be dominated by construction, right? I keep saying that. I said I. Mm-hmm. I didn't say we. I said
okay.
I don't want the fight to be dominated by construction, because how many of those jobs are going to be long-term? How many of those are going to be long-term sustained businesses, right? But if you're thinking along the lines of what are the peripheral services, if I'm going to come to Woodlawn, black people make barbecue. And barbecue is the hottest thing in the world. And is there a TIF fund that provides an incubator that over the next 2 years, because you know he was talking about construction, but is there an incubator that sends you to downtown for 2 years to learn how to run your restaurant so you're ready when it comes? I don't know. But again, I want to make sure that we think about where we can take the most advantage of the opportunity. Hey guys, this is going to be an ongoing debate for a long time. We got plenty of months and weeks to discuss it. But y'all saw, look, I'm not 100% in agreement with the way things are going, I am in agreement that there should be a library, but I want to make sure that it ain't the usual suspects. Hey, did you guys, oh, we got to go to trap news, traffic, and the weather, so we'll be back after that, plus Charles's choice. Then, Big O, we're going to ask you about what's going on with the Bears, as well as, did you see this, Charles? Did you see Karen Lewis has weighed in a county board race? What does the president of CTU got to do with Cook County? We're going to talk about that and more when we come back on the Talk of Chicago 1690 AM. Big O, what's up with the Bears, man? We took another nobody. Is this Mike Glennon part two?
Denise LaSalle.
Let's make a long story there.
She called Love from the very beginning.
You got to go.
Just let her play. She died this week, so.
Okay, now, Big O, go ahead.
You got another guy, another case of somebody being under somebody for 10 years, being the offensive coordinator. A young guy at that. What has Andy Reid won in the last 10 years?
Man!
He hadn't even won a playoff game.
What's the problem, man? What is the problem with the Bears?
The culture is this. I'm going to hire you. That job title right there is maybe a $3 or $4 million deal. But I'm gonna give you $1 million and you're gonna do what I say to
you. And you're gonna say you're the coach of the Bears.
Run it how I wanna run it. Now would they do what the Raiders just did?
Man,
Chuck gave Chucky $100 million. $100 million.
Hey, man, $2 million, you're getting that to be an assistant coach now.
Exactly. You know, so, you know, I'm tired of, you know.
What's the Bears' problem, though? Why don't they want to win?
McCaskey, they want everything for free, and they want the reputation, but they don't want to pay for it. The Bears ain't really, you think about it. In the 40s, they won a couple of championships, world championships.
In the
63 and 85. You look at that history, they ain't really done nothing. You know, but, you know, just still, you know, because George Halas has been, he's the founder. He bought that team and the league for $35,000 back in the day, and he took it from another guy.
We learned that that was...
And they built this thing, but they keep saying we're a mom and pop store, and we can't afford to pay people even under the salary cap for $35 million. For the last 5 years.
I heard the way that their deal is set up, though, that they can't reap the benefits of the Bears. They get an allocation, right? Like, I heard that they can't just spend as they want. The way Halas set the deal up was that they are forever, like...
Well, the money stays in the house.
They need to, man. They need to just sell the Bears to somebody like Robert Kraft.
Well, they're going
to
keep 51% of it like they got. And it's 31. I mean, it's 13 of them all throughout that organization, and none of them are football people. They don't know nothing about football.
And man,
nothing.
When I said I was there at the game when dude got beat up, when the McCaskey dude got beat up by the
a fan or something.
By the was it New Orleans game? What game was it? I got pictures of it. Like, cause my seats are right like one row behind him. So I was like, is that McCaskey? I was looking like, right, he sits there with that, like the Irish paperboy hat with his Bears jacket on. And I'm watching him, and this Saints fan, we was getting whooped, it was maybe like 3 years ago. It was a rash, and they was talking about him the whole time. He got up, the dude followed him out. He harassed him in the thing, and then they got into an altercation. And the security, man, I ain't never seen security vamp like that in my life. They was like, whoop, and got him. Man, I got pictures of it. Wow. That was crazy.
Yeah, well, you know, but the sad part about it is, we as fans keep coming back out disappointed.
I mean, I think as it becoming one of those lovable loser type of things, where we're enjoying, we just enjoy the misery of it all at this point.
You know, one of the biggest problems that Chicago has professional football. You only have one team. And this market could have two.
Exactly.
This market could have two teams if it wanted to. But the Bears would never allow it.
New York.
But It used to have two teams, and it would make this place a lot more competitive from the standpoint of football. The Bay Area has two teams, or had two teams. L.A. has two teams now. New York has two teams.
Yeah, that's Chicago first thing can't I thought sustain about. Two teams. Yeah, so you do they like New York, do, L.A. Yeah,
they could do two teams, and those teams would have to compete, and there would be, I think, a different look, particularly at the Bears.
They certainly would have to spend money there.
Yeah.
But when you're on the show in town, they're going to come see you. They hold us hostage. What is it, Nagy? Nagy?
Is that what they say his name? I never heard of the cat before.
Yeah, he's been with Andy Reid in Kansas City for 10 years, offensive coordinator.
I'll tell you, man, one thing, man.
Young guy.
I don't know that this quarterback is all that. I think he can play.
Not.
But I don't know that he's all
13
that.
13 games in college.
That's right. And never won anything. Not high school, college. Nothing. He never won.
Nothing.
E.J. Cutler was a – he won in
my idea of a quarterback, and I don't want to compare him to my era, but at least the work ethic, a nail with, you know, a Montana.
Oh, shit.
You know, Dan Marino, you know. You know, Danny White. I mean, these guys worked. I mean, they wanted the ball with 2 minutes to go in the game.
Right.
Now you're trying to label, we're going to make you great with an offensive coordinator. Offensive coordinator can't make you great.
That's true. And you know what else can't make you great? Receivers can't make you great.
Exactly.
You make the receiver great.
Exactly.
But your receiver, they're going to make you great.
So in other words, X's and O's are cool. But that locker room make you great. If we don't do it, it ain't going to get done. And they don't have no horses.
But we are broadcasting live from the King Breakfast. You coming?
The King Breakfast where?
On Monday.
This coming Monday?
You know how they do the one every year for for Jesse Jackson.
Oh, okay.
So, what you say?
On Monday, we go to the Hyatt?
Apparently, I'm going to read the promo.
I mean, look. You see
the promo? I haven't heard.
Just set it in front of me right now.
It's tough, man. That's a tough one. I tell you, man.
I think I'm just Uber. Somebody tell me, what is this man that he makes me feel? What I don't want to feel. Somebody tell me, what is this man that he makes me give? What I don't want to feel. On solid ground, I feel myself sinking. You are tuned in to the top of Chicago, 1690 AM, and every day at the 8:30 break, it's Charles's Choice. Charles, take it away.
That's Denise LaSalle. She transitioned earlier this week, and that was her big hit back in 1971.
Yeah, that was a great hit, too.
Great hit.
Did Jay-Z remix this? Because I sure missed this one. Hey, y'all. This Monday is Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day, and WVON is celebrating in a big way. Tune in Monday morning, because Charles, you and I, hey, I just found this out too, man. Did you know both of us are going to be broadcasting live from the Push Excel breakfast?
That's what I love about this job. Breaking news.
Breaking news.
Breaking
news. Now, breaking news. We're going to broadcast live from the Push Excel Scholarship Breakfast at the Downtown Hyatt. But later on that day, make sure you stop by DuSable Museum of African American History, located at 740 East 56th Place, for their annual King Day festivities. Cliff Kelly and Kimberly are going. We'll be broadcasting live from 3 to 7. Now, spend your King Day with the Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. So I thought King Day was a holiday. We don't get off that day. At the Black Station? You wait, we gotta go to work. Maybe we calling this a day of service. Well, I think they all days of service.
You'll be serving right now, right?
Sorry.
You might get a breakfast out of it.
You know what? They don't even think they give us a breakfast. You know what? I'm gonna tell y'all what. She said we couldn't talk about the Obama Library, but if we don't get no, if we don't get a plate, if I don't get a plate, y'all gonna be here. So y'all phones gonna be going off as y'all do.
You know, and we might not get a plate.
Well, you know what?
I didn't see anything on in there about a plate.
And you know what we need to check out too, man? We might need food testers. That's gonna be the Afrostocracy convention.
And you know this.
Say, man, you think we can get the Kennedys to come on? Because they all coming.
Oh, they'll come.
The whole family.
Uh-oh. The family?
Whole family is coming to the Kennedy. They're going to have a Kennedy table.
Wow.
Ooh.
The Kennedys.
Huh? Money table.
Man, look, the green team is on the move, plus that commercial. Now, you know, speaking of that commercial, Charles, everybody needs to tune in because Perry Small is going to have J.B. Pritzker on today.
Oh, I thought it was yesterday.
No, I thought it was too. It's today.
Today?
Today. So I'm going to tune in. I don't know what time, but as soon as
that
I do.
Was the same guy who was on the phone. That's JB on the phone.
You would think he wouldn't be calling in. You think he would want to just make sure
he's calling in.
Oh, man.
Wow. You kidding? He's not going to be. Oh, man.
He's calling in at 9 o'clock. Hey, man, JB. Hey, to my people over there. Y'all need to step off them phones, man.
Yeah, man. He's blocked, man.
They take
phone
calls.
Yeah, they used to call me on a cell phone.
And that was the FBI taping
them
too, right?
Yeah.
Dang.
Hey, man, you got the FBI taping you, man. Woo, and that's the Northern District.
You know, ham sandwich indictation.
Yes.
So, speaking of that, guys, Big O.
Yes, talk to me.
Big O, you know, a couple things. We had national championship this week. Bama coaches getting paid.
Game. Did you see the game?
Man, I saw the game. Great game. I was not rooting for Alabama,
freshman
quarterback and freshman receiver. What?
Yeah.
And that was a rope that he threw. Yeah. Man, that ball was never
after broke. Being sacked for 20, after being sucked for 20 yards right before. Did you see Nick Saban snapping off? Oh. And then the next lady was, yes, you're the greatest.
Hugging him. I love you.
He hit young blood in stride.
If you're Jalen Hurt though, you gotta be hurt. Because Jalen Hurt got like, their quarterback got like 3 years left or 2 years left.
Yeah, it was the first quarterback's playing.
But the original quarterback was the black quarterback with the dreads who had to sit down. They put him back in, pulled him out.
He's going to be sitting for a minute.
I think he's going to be transferring. Really? That's what I think he's going to be doing. Cause
well, I
you
think
can,
they'll keep both of them.
I think
they let them battle it out. Well, that's always the case.
Well, I heard they said that Nick Saban is liking the idea of a pass, so this guy might not come back. But we were talking to Sonny Vaccaro earlier this week about the fact that coaches are making $2 million a year, assistant football coaches. And then I was talking to you about the Bears just hired a new coach. And he didn't get the same amount of money. But, Big O, what's your thoughts on the Bears hiring this new coach?
Well, I'm not a big fan of recycling these guys. I mean,
but he's never been a coach before.
Well, he's in the system, the good old boy system. And you got a guy that's been, you know, in Kansas City for what, 10 years, offensive coordinator, been under, you know, Andy. And I always say, what has he done where he came from? I mean, you might be fine doing what you're doing in Kansas City, but how are you gonna take me in Chicago to the next level? And I just don't see that. I mean, and I don't understand why. But I do understand, so I'll take that back.
So what do you understand? Because don't be holding
out. It's all about money. You know, you have to spend money to make money.
You don't think they're spending enough?
I don't think they spending enough money, and I don't think they're looking sometime at the right people.
Who do you think would be the right people for the Bears? I mean, from your perspective.
I think
what's my boy from?
That's a good question, Charles, because I'm thinking of who's out there, and the first thing came to my mind. I'm looking at all the black coaches.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm talking about.
I'm looking at the black coaches, and you know some of them. Well, let's throw it out there. What about Les Frazier, that's been here in Chicago. That's a champion.
Les Frazier.
Yeah, Les Frazier, yes. That's playing the coaching now. He's a defensive back coach with the Baltimore Ravens. You know, what about, you know, I'll throw it out there because he's a good old boy, Mike Singletary. You know?
I think Mike got it.
Because he put that team in place in San Francisco. Then Harbaugh took over and got them to the championship. So,
man, I got another one too. Yeah. How about Lovie Smith? He was 10-6.
Yeah, 10-6.
He ain't doing too much for Illinois right now.
Well, but. See, the problem is, and the same thing here, you have to get the players. That's a process. You got to bring them in here, develop them, and then put them out there. And so there's a lot of guys that I think qualify, but for whatever reason, they're overlooking them.
They say for whatever reason?
They want
the
that person that's not going to make waves and say and do what they say do and how they do, and they just going to make money. Chicago has been, when you think about Michael, when he was in his day, Ryan's off of those guys, they win these championships, they don't give them a whole lot of money, and but they make a whole lot of money.
Buy low, sell high.
Yeah.
Hey, man, but I tell you, man, it's poetic justice with what's happening with the fact that the last black coach that the Bears had, they haven't come close to winning 10 games.
They fired him with 10 games, man. Yeah,
and these guys can't even win 5 games. Mm. Well, they won 5 games. They can't even win 6 games.
Big O, do you think race plays a role in the hiring of these football coaches?
Oh, race always plays a role in everything. I mean.
But Big O, I remember we had this talk.
Nah, I mean, it plays a role. I mean, when you look at certain things, I mean, you look at the league back a little bit before me when I came in, a black man couldn't play the quarterback position because he wasn't intelligent enough. He's not supposed to be a leader. So, yeah, I mean, you know, them owners are still there. Their mentality is still the same.
Big O, with so many black players in the league, doesn't it seem like black players would relate more to a black coach?
Well, I think they probably would, you know, no doubt about it. But you got to look at the system. I mean, there's a lot of black players in the league, but behind the league, behind the system, there's not a whole lot of black people.
I mean, general managers.
Decision making.
Player personnel.
We go out there and play the game, beat up ourselves, but we can't pick talent. You know, we can't run stuff. You know, so I mean, look at when Cap, when he sat down on the knee. You good enough to run the quarterback position, but when you start doing certain things, you know, the color's always a factor.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are tuned in to the Talk Chicago 1690 AM. I'm your host, Mays Jackson, Charles Thomas. Charles, when we come back, I know we gotta wrap it up, it's the weekend, but I got to talk about this Karen Lewis endorsement of Richard Boyke, Brandon Johnson. What does CTU got to do with the county? I don't know. We'll talk about it when we come back.
More of the morning show with Mays Jackson coming up.
Big O.
Yeah, baby.
So now, do you think that the Bears will ever reconnect with you all from the standpoint of, like,
they haven't done it by now. I don't think they're ever going to get done.
What's the
culture and the voice I've been hearing is, and we were in our heyday, and everybody just loved us. Now when we come around, we take from them.
Right, because I tell you.
My thing is, if you win football games, yeah, don't forget about it.
Yeah, well, you know, to be honest with you, man, I'm going to tell you, not that I would ever want to forget about you. One of the reasons I wanted to see the Bears win in 2006, the Super Bowl,
right,
is that finally we would be able to talk about
something else.
But nothing has ever happened. So we still got to talk about the 85 Bears.
Like Harold Washington.
Right, like Harold Washington.
Exactly. The same thing. It's like we froze in time. We got our one moment of glory, and we can't. Mike gave us 6, right?
Yeah.
And we'll hold on to them 6. And they, you know, and the Jewish people be like, well, we had them 6. We can roll this for another 20 years and not really have to invest and pay no money.
That's what they're doing.
Because y'all still hoping for Mike to come back.
And He gone. Yeah.
I mean, think about it. Michael Jordan was making $2 million a year?
When he first came, he was making his highest salary was $750,000.
Think about that. Damn.
Yeah. And he sat quiet. He said, okay, I ain't going to make no waves. Then his last contract was $65 million. But he made more money off the field.
Right, that's what they always said. Is Mike a billionaire?
Oh, yeah. He's close to it if he ain't.
Yeah, I heard he was. I mean, I read
he's up there, yeah.
I mean, that depends. You a billionaire this week.
You can be a billionaire, a liquid billionaire. Yeah, I'm asking, is he like a liquid billionaire?
Yeah, I don't know about that.
Right. Because you can be a billionaire.
I don't think Rounders a liquid billionaire.
Ken Griffin is. Did you see that mug just bought that grill? 58,000 square feet. $58 million in downtown. He bought a four-floor condo, 58,000 square feet. $58 million.
Something like that. I mean, what are you...
He's the richest man in the state. He like multi... That's like, you know, he be giving Bruce Rauner like $10, $20 million a pop. Like, oh, you need $20 million? Here you go, dog. I got you. That's my whole account.
Give going his wallet. See what you need. What you need? What's up? I got that. Yeah, here you go. That's cash.
Yeah. What you need?
That's what he keep around.
You already have a wallet.
Right, wallet.
That's what he keep around.
Right, he be like, go stop at this bank. Tell him I sent you.
Yeah. God, Dad, he go to ATM get that.
Right.
Got
right. What does his ATM withdraw?
He got black card.
Right.
Yeah, unlimited amount. Yeah.
Hey y'all. Johanna recovered from her bootyotomy yesterday. Very nicely. We didn't get any pictures, but she did. She had a bootyectomy yesterday.
That means you yank it out?
She took out the implants.
Yeah, okay. That means you took it out.
Yeah. Why she need implants, man?
Hey man, we sat right here and asked her. She said, because it was the thing to do. That's why I was trying to tell y'all, all these kids are out here trying to do this stuff. She didn't need that. And I'm saying, if you got a kid that is watching, grew up watching Kim Kardashian and all that stuff, or any of that, you don't even realize it because they on YouTube watching this stuff. That's how they was doing booty implants, sticking grease in their own butts. And man, please. You are tuned in to Talk of Chicago, 1690 AM. That Sonya is something else. But Charles, do you hear this song she talking about? Look, we got to go, man. But Karen Lewis has stepped into... Wait a minute. This is the same Karen Lewis that the Sun-Times earlier this week memorialized or released her obituary early. She came back roaring to life with an endorsement, a full-throated endorsement of Brandon Johnson, who actually does a show here on WVON in opposition to Richard Boykin.
And he has been a real trooper at CTU, I mean, for many years. Brandon has.
Yes.
He's a union member. He's a fighter. He's one of our frontline shock troops. But this isn't about the county board. Or even Brandon. This is about stopping, I believe, Richard Boykin. Now, they don't like Richard Boykin because of he's got some stuff in his past that has Republican stuff going on. He's also one who is more, I think, a more reasonable candidate about taxation. And Richard Boykin is positioned, as you know, not only to run for Congress, which everyone says he could do, he's also positioned. He could run for mayor as a county commissioner.
Damn!
He could, I mean, and that would really affect CTU if somebody like Richard Boykin,
damn,
who is a sort of a, not a tax and spend, not the classic tax and spend Democrat.
See, there you got that Republican.
They don't, I know, but they don't want a guy like that, maybe even positioned to run for mayor, so knock him off now.
Damn!
Right. Hey, that's just...
I don't know what, man... Opinion. That's a good analysis, though, brother. I'm gonna tell you, I, you know, he disappointed me when he didn't run or whatever for the county board president. But I like the fact that Richard Boykin is not scared to do something different, right? That is, I'm not always saying he's right, but I know he ain't just marching in lockstep. But I just wonder why Karen Lewis gets in this race, and if Brandon Johnson doesn't win, does it taint her credibility, or is she just being loyal to one of her soldiers?
It's gonna be a long shot for Brandon to beat Richard Boykin, I think. I mean,
now is this the queen paying Richard back as well? Big old, why you laughing? Whoa, is this the Queen Sugar?
Man, see, I hadn't thought about that.
Well, that's the first thing I thought was really? Queen Sugar saying.
Queen was involved with Karen?
Queen Sugar said, come on, man. Now, you know sisters talk, right? Light-skinned sister, close. They be come like, light, okay, sorry. Not light-skinned. But you know, they be like, now, sister girl. They had that meeting, and they say, you know what? This dude is getting out of, you know, this dude, Richard Boykin, been talking smack. You know what? I got you. We got Brandon. And Brandon, you know, Brandon is a G.
Is it what?
A G. I mean, when I say a G, Brandon got a nice following of people.
And you know, also, CTU has what? A lot of money.
A lot of money.
They got a political...
and they got a political army. They got a political army.
And they got an army, right?
Yes, they do. And then they got a second army, which is those teachers. The retired teachers. Because that, I'm going to tell you, it ain't the teachers that's going down. It's not the teachers that's current. It is CTU's retired pension teachers. Them people, they ain't playing.
I said that's interesting that you would think the queen, that President Preckwinkle would be involved in that, because I would think she's got her own stuff to be concerned about.
The queen thinks she is the queen. Mm-hmm. And the queen has been around here trying to body slam. You know, I told you about this. She's been around here trying to body slam people. And so... You know, I think that her premise was to make sure that you... The way it works in Illinois is, we might not beat you, but we want you to know that we were here. And we're going to make you spend some of that money, and we're going to make you work.
Yeah, do you think that... well, I'm not going to say that.
Say it.
No, I'm not.
You sure?
No, I'm not.
You positive?
No, I'm not.
You sure? Come on, Charles. I know you got a good one. I know it sounds like a zinger. Oh, yeah. See? You feel it? I can feel it. Can you feel it? Can you feel it? Oh, my God. Y'all, you know what? I did not bring Blake Moore out today. I mean, but Blackmore, the lion. The lion is not good. You know what? And somebody said there is a coincidence because the lion was not here today and because the lion tamer came.
Yeah, bro, the lion said...
I forgot about the lion!
But let me ask you this. What have you heard? Have you heard anything about any polling that may have been done relative to Fioretti? And...
No, you know what I told you last week, and I did not know, I cannot verify it, but I was told by someone I consider somewhat reputable that Bob Fioretti with nothing was in a dead heat with Madam Preckwinkle, and again, nothing has happened yet.
Wow.
Guys, I think, you know what, the other thing, Charles, I'm gonna have to talk about this. I wanna see if Mary Flowers is gonna come talk to us now.
Oh, really?
I wonder if Mary Flowers is gonna talk to us now, because she is one-on-one in a race with Willie Preston. And after 30 years of, I guess we're trying to ask her what she's been doing for the last 30 years, now she's going to have to explain it. You know, she hasn't ever had to really run against anybody.
And she won't debate him, will she?
No, she won't debate him, but I'm going to ask, can we make that official request that we have a Willie Preston, Mary Flowers debate right here? Right here, we're asking for it. I think we want all the uncontesteds, man. We want all the races where there's not the flood. Look, man. Where does the time go? The week goes. I swear, you get here on Monday morning dragging like, I gotta get up. And then it's Friday. And you like, we didn't finish yet.
And you know what?
What?
I can't wait till Monday morning.
You and me either, man. I'm gonna tell you. And so until then, for Annette Flournoy in the newsroom, for Miss Sonia Escobar, the musical conductor of the Soul Plane, for the Air Marshal in the building, my main man, Charles Thomas. My name is Maze Jackson. And you know, we got questions. We're going to keep on asking questions. And if they don't like it, you can still tell them. Maze said, we out of here. Peace.
The talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation. 1690.
Yeah. Whoa. Big O, you got something. You say what you got coming up. You got any appearances? You doing any book tours? You got some barbecue sauce? We going to... What we doing? What you got this week?
Right now, this week, I got a meeting today with CPS.
Uh-oh. They better tell Jet... You, Janice,
Mickey Pruitt and Jatan Jackson, and trying to get my, you know, organize my football program.
Okay, good.
I'm building up my 707 program.
Man.
So I got to make sure, you know, keep their support, which, you know, Mickey ain't gonna do a whole lot.
That's all right, Janice ain't gonna cut you.
Yeah.
They need you.
Yeah, they do. These kids need it.
Hey man, you know what?
Because I'm putting a scholarship program together.
Oh, that's right.
I want to, you know, I want to.
Big O, I want to be in on the football stuff, man.
Yeah,
bro. I want to be in.
You know, keep doing the loop.
All right, Charles, anything?
There's coffee in here. No, I'll be back Monday, man.
See y'all at the King breakfast. All right, y'all.
At the Kang breakfast.
At the Kang.
Kang breakfast.
Here come the Kang. All right, y'all. We out of here. Peace.
Off the phone with this woman who wants to invite you to participate in something coming up at Morgan Park High School. I told her to.